Throwback Thursday with Covino Rich.
Hi, my name is what? My name is.
Are you telling me you built a time machine out of a DeLorean?
Throwback Thursday.
I don't even own a gun, let alone many guns that would necessitate an entire rack.
Throwback Thursday.
I'll tell you how I became the prince of a town called Bel Air.
Bueller.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
Ned Ryerson.
Bang!
From my heart and from my hand, why don't people understand?
Two in the box, ready to go.
We be fast and stay be slow.
It's Throwback Thursday with Covino and Rich.
Ladies and gentlemen, let us honor America as Mr. Palazzo will now sing our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed in
Frank?
Stripes and broad stars in the perilous night. On our ramparts we watched.
And the rockets lit their button bombs in the air. It proved to the
How do I deal with you every day?
Get bent. No.
Turn on the radio.
Get ready.
Whoa! Yeah!
Holy mother nugget!
And
holy mother meatball!
Can't knock the hustle.
I'm the smartest man alive!
You're so ridiculous.
What?
You're such a fool.
Get out of here.
Oh, I'm a disc jockey.
What's a disc jockey?
Turn it up.
Here we go.
Covino and Rich.
Let's go.
I want the world to know that I'm waiting to share my first sip of coffee, my first cup of joe, my first sipperoo with you. Cheers. Good morning. Good day.
What a guy.
Don't talk to me until I've had my...
All right.
Throwing it back on a Thursday. It's Covino and Rich. What's up?
Hey, Tom.
Orale. What's good? How you feeling?
Feeling a little better, but not really.
Yeah, I could tell.
I just couldn't get comfortable at all yesterday. That's the worst part about being sick.
Well, we still have to be rocking out. Let's go. Go from the couch to the bed to another bed to the couch. You're like, where could I get comfortable?
God, you just can't get comfortable.
Well,
no sleep. Just
get comfortable for
weak
the next
feeling.
2 hours, right, Jonah? Thank you for hanging out with us. Appreciate all the feedback. We got stories to tell. We got things to get into. Rich has to start feeling better. Look at this guy. He's a mess. He's got a big jug of tea. He's got a lemon. He's got a whole thing of honey.
Got honey.
He's got a little piece of cake.
Got a lemon.
Because he eats like a gerbil throughout the show.
Yeah, I don't know.
Welcome.
So chugging honey.
Welcome. Welcome. He's got an antique frame behind him that he got at the Antique Roadshow. Grandma's frame.
I do.
You love
that.
Yeah. Rich has got it going on. He's got his tiger shirt.
So, yeah.
Just, fart on the wall.
Just feel like ass.
Ass burgers.
Ass soup.
Ass soup. Sopa de culo.
Yeah, I so badly want to just feel better. Like, yeah. I tried to sleep as much as possible yesterday, but still, I couldn't do it. You can't sleep.
Like, Evaristo Trevino says, health is wealth, man. Gotta appreciate the good days.
Oh my God. When you feel shitty, you realize how much for granted you take the days where you're just like super happy and lively.
Well, I hope people appreciate that. Even yesterday, when you were feeling like doo-doo pie, pushed through it and we had a fun show. If you missed anything, catch up on our Patreon. Welcome to the last day of Junio.
Oh, that's right.
Tomorrow's the first day of Julio. It's the first of the month. So go out on top, have a good one, and have stories to tell, Rich. Anyway, before we do that, Throwback Thursday, shout out to Super Rare Shop. This is one of the OGs, the official 1994 Hogoff champion t-shirt.
Wow.
From back in the day. Yeah, wear this one with pride. Look at that, man. Soft chub division. Look at
that. Half chub division.
Soft chub. It was a misprint. It was really the soft chub division, but the shirt said half chub.
What's the difference between a half chub and a soft chub?
I don't know. That's why it's confusing. But the Hogoff champ is here, 1994. Oh. Welcome to the show. Speaking of shirts, we got some new ones available. Tell you about that later. But yesterday, man, after the show, I was feeling really good about it until I read the feedback.
You know what, Andrew?
Thought we had a really good show.
I might go outside for a few minutes. Andrew had a good idea. He goes, have I tried sunning my butthole? That might be what I need.
Yeah, it's good.
I tried sunning my butt. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do that. I'm like the Cal Ripken, but I suck at baseball.
When did you stop?
Yeah, no. After the show yesterday, tell me what you did because I have nothing of interest.
Yeah, Rich was trying to get comfortable for hours.
For 12
Rich,
hours.
Rich actually called out of SiriusXM yesterday.
Yeah.
Something he never does. Something that everyone else seems to do. I know a guy who's called out for 4 months. And I've been filling in like a jerk off.
I know a guy who's a sucker.
Yeah.
I called out today again.
Yeah. Rich called out. That's how sick he is.
I was like, listen. If
it proves anything to you.
I was like, you know, I'm just not feeling good. But I realize everyone else, like you said, takes sick days.
Yeah.
So why should I not take sick days?
I'm not saying people shouldn't take sick days, but it feels like people fucking stub their toe and calling sick all the time. Bunch of lamos. But anyhow, after the show yesterday, thought we had a really fun show, regardless of Rich feeling under the weather. Thought we covered a lot of funny stuff. So I hope you enjoyed it. And I rushed home to pick up Melody. You know, dad life never stops, right? Real life never stops. Rushed home to get her to art camp on time. Of course I didn't, you know, late.
How late were you?
Like about 15 minutes late.
Oh,
she missed finger painting.
Yeah, no, she's advanced, man. She's in some, just trying to hone her skills. I made a mission statement for Melody, as all parents should do, I would imagine, right? I said, we want to leave this summer better than we started it. So how are we going to get better? We're going to be healthier. You're going to be a better artist. You're going to make more money. You know, we're going to have a lot more fun, more stories to tell when school starts again. We're all going to be better after this summer. So she made some goals, right? She's going to be better at the ukulele, get her art skills up. That should be everybody's goal. So I'll be a little better by the end of the summer. So took her to art class and driving back 4 hours later, have to pick her back up in art class. And it's far away, dude. That's the thing that people don't realize. You know, it could be 30 minutes away, but that's like 45 minutes away with LA traffic, right?
So it's 45 minutes away then.
Gas prices and, you know, all that shit adds up. My emergency alert goes off. What is that? Oh, check tire pressure again?
Oh, no.
I was just there and I am completely 100% convinced. 100% convinced that it's a scam, it's a racket, it's bullshit, really. I swear the local tire shop hires some kid to just throw nails and screws on people's tires.
It's possible.
There's no freaking way, dude. I know it happens all the time. It's common that a nail gets caught in the tire, a piece of metal, a screw, but like not three times in the past, like month and a half, 2 months.
Yeah, that's a bit much.
Right? And then one of the times I went to the tire place, Tire World, the guy said,
hey, Lou.
He said, what's your address again? 3382. Sounds familiar. You know what? Something's going on there. I've had like five cars from that complex coming in the past week. So I really believe that someone has a vendetta not just against me, maybe the building, or maybe I do have an enemy. I don't know. But Spot, again, I was just there.
Are you the Tinder swindler?
Maybe there is a scheme.
Are your enemies after you?
Mike, I'm not paranoid. It happens too often. And it's not easy to get a full-on screw. Like, look at the picture. I took a picture of it. I'm like, it's ridiculous, man. It's too often that this happens. Look at that. Yeah. Oh, wow. Dude, on that tire alone, just to drill it in.
Otherwise, really good tread.
Just to drill it in. Yeah, as people hit me up with tread that dope, it looks like it had to be screwed in.
Yeah, it doesn't even look like it's... like it's really in there. It's really all up in there.
The guy's like, you again? I'm like, yeah.
Me again.
He's like, you must have enemy. I'm like, I don't know. Right? Yeah. It's called karma's my enemy. He goes, once they take the tire out, they patch it from the inside.
Yeah.
Right? Sometimes people plug it, but sometimes you get a patch from the inside. Yeah. He goes, this is the third time on this tire alone that this has happened to you, because they could see how many times they patched it. He goes, God. One more time. He goes, you're going to need a new tire. I'm like, what the fuck? What the fuck?
Do you get a stamp card? Next one's a free tire?
For every...
How many times your tire's been messed with?
They get a free one, right? Yo, 35
buy
beans.
Buy 10 tires, get one free.
35 beans every time, man. And it's like... And it's not even the $35 that bothers you. It's the aggravation of having to go there every time. Because you don't want to take that chance, especially when you're driving with your kid around, like... have a blowout, you're down a tire. Like, you don't want to deal with that hassle in the Huff. You don't know how low the tire's getting the whole time.
Someone in your building must just be, like, taking handfuls of nails and be like, aha! Like, what could it be?
The nail fairy is out to get me. I don't know, man, but it keeps happening. So it's an ongoing saga. And
by the way,
for those that follow me on social media, you know I was there recently.
Is this the blowout you're trying to avoid?
Look at that hair. Look at that hair. Dude, that must be like, you know when people Photoshop and they don't tell you?
No, that's
someone
real.
Photoshopped my head like 3 inches. They gave me a 6 head and they put my hair up. I don't know what's more inflated, my tire now or my hair.
That's the blowout you're trying to avoid.
What is the hair about in that photo? But honestly, man, it's like, I think I might have an enemy. Which means greatness is just around the corner.
Do you have...
every Ali needs their Frasier.
Do you have an assigned parking
every Coke
spot
needs their Pepsi.
Right in your...
course.
Yeah, so...
Oh, maybe it's the... Because we know the previous tenant was doing some shady stuff.
I don't know.
I think that's it. I think he thinks you're the guy, the Russian dude that owned the place before him.
Well, hey, my stories are true. I'm just sharing them with you.
Or are you just careless? Do you like drive around over things that you shouldn't?
Yeah, all the time. I go over construction sites.
Yeah, no, do you like...
There's a guy, he's like, what's up?
Let me drive close.
I just drive over all, you know, sorts of shit all the time. I go off-roading in my Honda Civic over construction sites. Anytime it says men at work, I'm like...
I picture you driving around like Mr. Magoo. And like, you don't realize where you're driving. You're just like, and you wind up in your destination not realizing that you just terrorized an entire city.
Yeah, Josh, just one enemy. Well, I made a few yesterday on social media because I'm so sick of everybody's opinion. People should take their opinions and shove them up there. A real life enemy. I'm not sure I've had one in years.
That's just really inconvenient.
That's just inconvenience, really. You're right.
What a pain in the ass.
Such a pain in the ass. And you can't take the chance. It's not like you could put it on hold. Yeah. Right? And it diverts your whole day. It really does. I know it was only like maybe a 45-minute out-of-my-way thing. But that was like my gym time.
Did you see it right away?
I still had to go home and work and then pick Melody back up and, you know.
Did they see it or did you see it?
I found it.
Oh, you say it? Yeah. It's pretty obvious. I was going to say it's right there. Screwed in.
Because when something like that happens, you're like, yeah, I'm good on whatever you were going to do. Like get a haircut, go to the gym, take a walk. Yeah, I was going to go to Trader Joe's. No, no Trader Joe's. No walk. That ruined my whole day. So that was yesterday.
Yep.
In a nutshell.
Yeah, there's got to be someone. I'm wondering who'd be mad at you.
While Rich was laying there like Anthony Anderson. You know the meme, right, Spot? What's he crying about in that meme? You've watched that show, Blackish.
I don't know, but yeah,
him
crying is a meme for sure.
Rich was just there trying to recover.
Must be good things coming, says Lisa. Well, great Lisa, things are coming. You're attracting things to you. Just it's starting with nails. It'll be good things eventually.
Lisa's a hippy dippy with her beliefs, you know, and I appreciate that. And I love the positive outlook. So, like I said, rivals bring out greatness. I think someone's out to get me and I just have to overcome. It didn't fire me down. It just made me say, what's going on?
Another nail.
Yeah. Huh. It's too much of a coincidence on a throwback Thursday.
Yeah.
But that happened. So then finally I got all my work done. Checked in with Rich. He was crying like Anthony Anderson.
Oh, I got the sniffly whifflies.
The what?
Sniffly whifflies. Oh, and I got the sniffly whifflies bad.
The whole family does, yeah. Right? And, you know, finally I got to chill out and relax. I missed the Yankees because they were on early, but I still watched them. How's that for that? I watched a recap. I still watched it even though I knew they won. I didn't tell Jordan that I knew they won. I just left it on.
And you watched the whole game?
Most of it, yeah.
Why would you not just fast forward
to... Once I knew the final score and they got to the final score, I was like, you know what? What do you want to watch?
That's fun. My dad will DVR every Mets game, but he'll just fast forward to the innings where the runs are scored.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the best way to watch baseball.
Nah, I like it, man. I enjoy it. You're telling me to rush through something I enjoy. I actually enjoy it.
It's my comfort food.
It's my pizza, man. I love that shit. So
pizza.
Pizza, bro. Pizza. So then I pulled a move because I've noticed Jordan has been... Subconsciously, I don't think it's conscious. I don't think she's ever nice to me consciously, but subconsciously,
yeah.
She's like, "Do you want to watch Indiana Jones?" And I'm like, "What?
What?"
She's like, "I don't think I ever saw the first one." I'm like,
"What?
What?
What?"
So yesterday,
Raiders.
Yeah, we watched it recently. Yeah,
really?
Like over the weekend. Yeah, we watched the first one, which still holds up. The special effects are weak.
So
you know,
weak.
You can't watch that movie, especially with someone who's born in the '90s and not here.
That's weak green screen.
Well,
it was when you look back.
Dr. Jones. Pass me the whip. Dr. Jones, we meet again. Ah, my friend, Mr. Jones. Dr. Jones, good to see you. So she's been throwing those out there and enjoying some of the classics with me lately. I said, hey, Jordan.
You mean to tell me that these effects are not state of the art?
Yeah, when his face melts.
That's awesome.
It's still awesome, but
I mean, it's pretty cool for what year was this?
It's sad that 82? Kids could do better things on their filters on their phone.
I could make you melt right now. Don't look at it.
So yesterday, sorry. I pulled a little. You know what? You want to watch the Kardashians? Let's watch the Kardashians. Let's watch them.
Oh, okay.
But she thinks that I secretly want to watch the Kardashians. And that's not really true. I just tolerate the Kardashians. Because even though it's trash,
yep,
it's entertaining, right? And speaking of trash, if you're feeling like trash today, remember, it's garbage can, not garbage can't.
Just trying to keep that in mind.
Just trying to stay positive, Lisa Praggio.
Garbage can. Garbage can.
It's garbage can. And I'm not here to bore you about the Kardashians, but I am here to tell you, in a nutshell, I could tell you why they're different. As we look at Oscar the Grouch on our...
Just because you're trash. Screen. Just because you're trash.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean you can't do great things. It's called garbage can, not garbage cannot.
Not garbage cannot. Thank you, Oscar the Grouch.
Thanks, Oscar the Grouch.
Who's voiced by the same person that does Big Bird. A lot of people don't know that. So, Kim Kardashian is simply discussing how she ended up with Pete Davidson because she heard about the BDE and was really just DTF. She wasn't looking for a relationship.
Wait. So, did she use all those?
Yes.
Yeah. Phrases?
Yeah, yes.
I was DTF trying. Yes. And he had BDE. Really? Yes. Okay.
Yeah. And she's then telling her sisters about Pete. And they're like, oh, yeah. Ooh, tell us. So what is going on? And long story short, she says, it's like grandma always said. And I'm like, oh, what did grandma always say? sex is going to be way better when you hit your 40s. And she's like giggling about it. And they're like, grandma said that? And I'm like, that's grandma? Pretty much why they are who they are.
Tita said that?
My Tita, my Nana would never, ever in a million trillion years have said anything remotely close.
Maybe she did and you just didn't understand it because she spoke Spanish.
Not even fucking in the ballpark. And that, in a nutshell, is why they are who they are and why they're different. And, you know, I would have never heard some shit like that from my grandparents. Ever. Not even my grandfather's.
Well, maybe they were thinking it and just didn't say it.
Who says that to their grandchildren? Give me a break.
I mean, they're grown up.
Yeah, still, dude, come on. And then you think to yourself, this old biddy's still alive? God bless her, knock on wood. Because if Kim is 41, 42.
Grandma's going to be like 90.
And Chris, right? Chris Jong-un, as Kanye called her. She's got to be, what, 60-something?
Yeah.
Which means the grandma has to be like 90-something years old talking about getting it good. What is going on in that family? So that was my unwinding of my Wednesday night, and here we are on a throwback Thursday.
Wait, is this the grandma?
Yes! Yo!
She looks so young!
I know! What is going on there? Was she 12 when she had Kris Jenner? Uh-huh.
Yeah, baby.
Yeah.
Yeah, she looks better than me.
She's my inspiration. Uh-huh.
I know someday I'll look like...
That's Kris's mom. That's Kim's mom's mom. Who told her,
just wait till you hit your 40s, honey. You're going to be getting it good, better than ever.
So like, she confirmed that Pete Davidson is an amazing lover?
She confirmed.
She's 87.
Yeah. He's laying it down. Yeah, 87. She's still bringing it.
So she confirms that Pete Davidson is delivering.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
And they're all like, ooh.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm not here to tell you about them. I'm here to tell you. The difference is in families sometimes. You know, you see somebody like, this guy's an interesting character. Yeah, it didn't happen by accident. Happened because they're from a family of interesting people.
Yeah.
That's really, I mean, you're a product. That's
I feel
it.
Like a lot of people have that spunky grandma. You know,
grandmas talk like that, bro. Give me a break.
Like my friend always had a spunky grandma.
Grandmas make cookies and wear aprons.
Yeah, she wasn't talking about, you know,
old grandmas
getting pounded after 40.
Grandmas wear muumuus.
Not grandmas of the future.
Grandmas of the future. She's 87, dude.
She's still within like.
She's within our grandma's range.
She's within our grandma range. Maybe the next generation, like when you become a grandparent. So in like 30 years.
I'll never cross that line, man.
No, you will.
Now, you think I'm going to tell my grandkids someday, hey, you know, if there's no ring on the finger, the penis can linger. That's what grandpa used to say.
Let me tell you something, Zork.
Hey, Zork. Yeah.
When in my day, I used to bang bitches from behind.
It's like inappropriate, man.
And let me tell you, I hit my peak when I was 40. I was banging a young girl. She was a fine piece.
She's 87, the grandma.
But clearly you can see why they're so open sexually. You could now see why the word vagina is spit out on that show 87 times an episode. It's like, yo, can you chill with that?
Technical.
Like, it's bothering me.
They're very sexual.
Yeah. So it makes sense, right? It just makes you think. You know?
What about if grandma has 16 kids like Mauser's grandma? Doesn't that just speak louder than words?
She doesn't have to say a damn thing. You know she was...
16 kids?
Yeah.
When people have more than 4 or 5 kids, I'm like, that means they just kept having, like, one after the other? Just boom,
yeah.
Boom, boom, yep. Next.
Well, remember, I'm not here to tell you about the Kardashians. So if you can't decipher through this story, it was just to tell you that the apples don't fall far from the tree, you know, and that's just really how it is. There's a reason they're very sexual and open and honest about their love life and things like that. Look at what the grandma was saying to them.
Yeah.
So it just is what it is.
Everyone's different.
You know, hey, Covino's so uptight. Yeah, because I come from a line of uptight people.
The best way to get over someone.
I'm just making it clear.
Just get under someone else, am I right?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of pervy old grandpappies out there.
Grandpappies I could see.
And grandmas too now, apparently.
What do you think the next generation?
That's not the next generation, no, dude.
What I'm saying
is like the same age as our grandparents almost. Same age. He's 87. It's not next generation. It's this generation.
It does explain it. You're right.
You know, it just goes to show you. It's just the proof. The proof in the pudding. That's all I'm saying. It's like, you know, I'm stating the obvious.
I love pudding.
It's an obvious observation. But, you know, Rich is a very talkative fella who loves to talk about gambling and sports. Meet his dad. Oh, I'm gonna tell you about Escobar. Escobar is doing really good for the man. Oh, I put some money down. Go back another generation, you probably get a version of the same thing.
Doesn't fall far from the tree.
Nope.
Even because
I heard
Grandma Jenner.
I'm like, my grandma. What, no, that's grandma.
Well, yeah.
Whatever the maiden name for Chris's. Yeah.
My grandma
would never say that. Oh, but theirs would, so that makes sense.
What an interesting life that grandma must have. Watch her daughter and grandkids turn into this global empire.
This is insane. All right, so that was my
Mary Jo
Wednesday night. That's her name, Mary Jo.
Mary Jo.
But if Fuoco.
But if Mary Jo.
On a throwback
but
Thursday.
A Fuoco. Yes.
On a throwback Thursday.
Mary Jo, but a Fuoco.
You know, I was watching.
What's she up to?
I don't know. She's just living large, man. Living large and in charge. So then I watched that. I hopped in the shower. I did the scrub-a-dub-dub with my sacate. And I'm always, you play music when you're in the shower?
Yeah,
no?
Yeah? I do, actually.
To muffle the farts or to actually enjoy the music?
Just to, like, and also to time myself. Like, I know that each song's like, roughly 3 minutes or so. So I'm like, if I hear more than three songs, I'm like wasting too much time.
You're concerned about your shower time?
No, because I'm usually, I don't, yeah, probably because I'm probably wanting to get ready.
But don't you just go in, complete the task of showering and leave?
Like, sometimes you just stand there with the water hitting your head for a while, just being like, oh.
Sometimes I sit in a ball underneath the faucet with mascara running.
No, I took a, Sarah made me a bath yesterday. Oh, yeah. And I was like, you know what?
Use a bath bomb?
Like a eucalyptus salt.
What kind?
Like a eucalyptus?
Eucalyptus dick. Not Mr. Bumble? You should have went Mr. Bumble, bro. Mr. Bumble. That was my guy.
And yeah, that was again, felt nice, but can't do it for too long.
They make those shower tablets, too, that the steam.
He really was Anthony Anderson yesterday. Sarah had to make you a bath.
Yeah, she made me. Yeah, she was trying to be all nice.
What? No, it's nice of Sarah, but I feel
isn't
you like
Sarah also sick.
Ooh, yeah, she was.
Did you draw her a bath?
No, she's good. She's fine. Sarah's good. The kids, Emmy's feeling a little better now. So now it's just me and Ben.
Well, that's good. I played my '90s. I got something called '90s rock one hits, which is obviously my favorite one hit wonders. Let's give it a little shuffle roo. Ready?
Mother.
I mean, good song. Danzig only had like.
Do you mind if I draw you a bath?
One commercially awesome song at that time, Glenn Danzig. Mother, how about this one? Oh yeah.
Oh.
As I scrubbed my space hog.
In the meantime.
In the shower. Okay. So. I'm in the, I got the shower getting ready. Shower I'm dropping a deuce. And my buddy hits me up. I was like, can you talk? And I was like,
turn that off.
Can you talk? That's an odd thing to say.
Can you talk? Insinuate something's up.
Yeah, yeah.
Something's up.
He said, yo, hermano. I said, sup? Can you talk? About to hop in the shower. Everything good? Oh, I just got to ask you something.
Yeah.
Yes, why? What is it? So I hit him up on the speakerphone. I'm like, I'm taking a shit, but you know, what's up, man? You all right? I didn't want to call you while I was taking a shit, but
no, I just get the vibe like someone needs money.
No,
someone
no,
wants
no,
something.
No.
Someone's got some drama.
One of my best college buds, right? Yeah. I've known him forever.
Ah, someone died.
No. But it's a good story. I don't know the rules. There's no blueprints on these things. There's just feelings, and you try to do your best to be honest and be a good person, right? I don't think there's, well, here's how you do it, and this is the only way. My buddy, unfortunately, is going through a separation / divorce, right? It's a nightmare. It really is. It sucks. It's sad, but it's life.
Yeah.
And you move on, you move forward, whatever.
You've been there.
But he's in it. And when you're in it, it blows. And he said, listen, you know, I've been seeing this new woman for a while now. I've been seeing this new woman for about a year since they've been separated, right?
Was she part of the reason for the...
No.
No, okay.
No, it was one of those relationships that sort of ran their course and you're just not happy in it. It's just mundane. There's no...
They have kids?
Lovey, dovey, sex time. Yeah, 3-4 kids. Yeah, family, house, lots of assets, right? Years together. Like history now. We're at the point now, if your friends got married in their 20s, they've been together a long time, right?
Yeah, no, it's true.
So a lot of history there, but I think in this case, it's just you start realizing that this person doesn't appreciate like the person that I am. They're sort of like, they don't love me the way I want to be loved or appreciate me the way I want to be appreciated.
Yeah.
Right? And sometimes it is other people that bring that out. You're so funny. Really? My wife doesn't laugh at anything I say.
Well,
right?
When you bump into those scenarios, that's when people cheat and up to no good because they're right. feeling appreciated.
Anyway, he started to notice that, this just isn't fun. I'm with a cold person, kind of, right? That's the backstory. Anywho, they have been open and honest about, look, this isn't working. This is over. Let's get separated. We're going to get a divorce. All right. That sucks. It blows. Whatever. But they also agreed to just stay under the same roof until they get the kids through school. So I think the kids are on the brink of all being done. Right? But they made that agreement. And I only give you that caveat because I'm wondering if this is the reason there's an issue or this is the reason that makes you say, So they're still under the same roof. That's really all you need to know.
Things that make you go,
If you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Okay, I will.
So my buddy hits me up and he goes, Steve, I want to know, because I'm feeling really guilty right now and I feel like shit and I feel terrible. I want to know if you think I did anything wrong, man, because I'm trying to be honest. And, I just feel like I maybe fucked up and I just hate the way she's making me feel.
Okay.
That was never the intention.
Yeah.
He goes, I've been seeing this new woman now that I like a lot and I really care about her. And, we had already told our kids, they collectively as a couple told their kids, we're going to be seeing other people. We're no longer together.
Then throw in. And a reminder, after 40, sex is best.
Yeah, no. But we're still family. Jeez. And, we still are always going to be your mom and dad. They had that whole talk.
We're always going to be your mom and dad. We're not going to love you any less.
But what? I'm not saying it's any easier.
It's not your fault.
But when you're in your teens, I'm sure it's a little more understandable.
Yeah.
Right? Than telling some kid that doesn't understand, so what does that mean? You're no longer my mom and dad? Little kids don't know how to understand that.
Yeah, no, it's... My parents got divorced when I was a teenager.
Right.
And I felt like not much care because I was already living my own teen life.
So they had that talk with their kids. It's about a year later. He's in the car with his oldest son. And he sees that the new girl is calling him. And he says to his son, hey, it's my girlfriend. It's my new girlfriend. Are you okay if I answer the phone right now? And he's like, yeah, Dad, of course.
How old's his son?
And his son's probably aware enough to know that my dad's a good guy, and I just want my dad to be happy.
How old's his son?
17.
Okay.
Right?
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So you sure?
He's no strangers to the ways of the women.
So he answers the call, and the woman doesn't say anything like, hey, I'm going to be your new mom. Nothing intrusive.
Your new mom. This was on car speakerphone.
So he answers
the Bluetooth.
And he's like, hey, Joanna, making shit up, right?
Yeah.
Hey, Joanna, I'm here with Mark. Oh, hey, Mark. Nice to meet you finally. You've heard great things. Very simple. Yeah. Very so we're just going to the store. But anyway, I'm just, I hope you have a good day. All right, Mark. Hey, nice to meet you. All right, bye. Right? Just simple,
sounds
awkward.
Pretty easy.
Okay.
That sounds okay.
Another month goes by. About a month later, he's in the car with his daughter, who's maybe 14, 15. Same thing happens. Same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, hey, mind? No, Dad, I don't mind.
Yeah.
You sure? You sure? Just want to make sure you're okay. You're okay with everything? Yeah, yeah, of course, Dad. Just want you to be happy. Answers the phone. Same exact thing. Oh, hey, you know, oh, I just can't wait to meet you.
I'm your new mom.
No, but I can't.
You're going to live with me now.
I heard you're so great, and I, you know, I'm so excited to maybe meet you someday. Anyway, have fun, guys. Bye, bye, bye.
Yeah.
Few days later, remember him and the ex live together still. It comes up in conversation somehow that, yeah, the kids already talked to the new girl. Right? There's no surprise that there's a new girl. The ex knows there's a new girl.
Yeah.
The ex has a major freak out, flip out. Like disastrous storm ensues. Because she's like, how in the world do you not run that by me? You got to tell me first before you introduce our kids to the new person.
They're not kids.
And
I don't know.
And it was a phone call.
The only, and I'm like, no way. You're in the right, you're my bro. So automatically I'm like, you don't owe her anything. This is your personal life.
Are they, they're divorced?
And these are your kids. They're separated.
Okay.
And then I was talking it over with Jordan and everything, and she said something I didn't even think about. She goes, well, they're under the same roof. If they could discuss, like, who's taking the garbage out still, he couldn't run that by her. They're under the same roof. They're not sleeping in the same room. They're under the same roof. He could have gave her the courtesy, but again, it was spontaneous. And then she was saying, maybe she's protecting the kids because the kids still see them all under the same roof. Maybe there's still the hope that mom and dad could work it out and they're going to get back together. So the mom is extra emotional and upset and mad about this because, you know, let's not play with our kids' emotions. They might still be thinking that there's a chance here because we're still all together. And you're introducing them to some other woman? So, I start thinking about all the rules and how things played out for me and all, you know, all these sorts of scenarios. And I'm like, nah, dude, this is your personal life now. And unfortunately, you're going to have to trust each other's judgment moving forward. If she would have said no, she's now controlling your personal life when you guys are no longer technically together. Imagine, look, I want to introduce them to this person that I care about. Yeah, no, I don't feel good about that. How is the person you're not even with still controlling your life?
It's unconventional that they're still living in the same house.
But does that make it any different? That's why I brought that up, because I'm like, is that the difference maker? I don't know. But he's my bud. So I felt terrible for him because I know there's no malicious intent here. This dude's just trying to be happy at this point in his life.
I think the reality is upsetting her.
Yeah.
The reality that, it's every couple says that they're going to be cool with everything until there's a new guy or a new girl in the picture. Then no one is cool anymore. Everyone thinks they could handle it, and everyone thinks they could be cool with it. But the minute some new guy's around or new woman's around, that's when it blows up. And I think she's just sad that, oh, wow, it's my ex-husband's actually moved on.
The finale.
Bam!
It's the finality of it, right?
Finality.
Like, I said, you could talk a big game all you want, but until there's a guy or girl in the mix,
there's always a glimmer of hope.
Yeah, well,
that things
know.
Are going to just reconcile.
And the simple fact that these kids are not kids, 14 and 17, they don't have to baby them.
I said, clearly, man, she's just shocked that Joanna means enough for you to do this. I said, yeah, I remember thinking that. Now that I go back into my thought process, thinking like, damn, like I didn't expect my ex to run it by me. It was just the shock that she was way ahead of me in this process.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Know who it stings for? It stings for the person in the relationship that moves on second. Because if you break up with, if you get divorced, if you're the person that moves on first, you probably feel a little guilty, but you're in the power position.
But I thought you said they both had people.
Yeah, but
like when
does
they,
she not have
she
a
hasn't introduced anybody, you know?
Okay, so that's the issue here. She has someone.
Yeah, so it's not as serious, clearly. So it's the realization of, wow, you're that serious with this new person that you wanted to introduce them to our kids. It's just you're going to be upset in that moment. You just are.
It was a phone call. It wasn't like they went away together, had dinner together, yeah. Did anything fancy.
And now she's telling him to get the fuck out. Oh. You know, it's the ugliness is starting to rear its head, and my buddy's like, "Fuck, dude, did I fuck up?" And I'm like, "No, well, man, you didn't."
Did they also live in the same house because it just financially makes sense too?
Yeah, I'm sure. Like, you know, there's still a lot to figure out. Let's be adults about this, you know, and let's still be here for the kids while we can.
So were they wanting to stay in the same house until the kids were... You said they have how many kids?
3, 4. I'm trying to be vague about it.
I was going to say, if the kids are younger, that's a lot of biding your time. If the youngest kid's 14, then it's like, all right.
I think he meant maybe the school year or something. So like now... He's going to have to figure it out.
Yeah,
or maybe
the
oldest or the few oldest get through school. I don't know what he meant by that.
If you got kids that
he was 16, trying to wait till they got through school.
If you got kids that are like 15 and 17 and you're like, yeah, we're going to get divorced. It doesn't seem crazy to say, well, you know what? Until the 15-year-old graduates, like in a year and a half, we'll do our own thing, but we'll just live in the same house for a lot of reasons. Yeah, but
it's weird.
You know, it's weird, Rolando's feedback. Okay. Hey, bud, I can't not notice that. Sorry. Thanks. Thanks, Rolando. I don't even know what that means. But anyway, it made me also think of, you know, the rights and wrongs. And you don't really know. There's no blueprint. And he definitely had his kid's best interest in mind. And I believed him there. But then he told me his dad said, he asked his dad. He felt terrible about it. Dad, what do you think? He's like, as long as you were honest with your kids, that's all you could do. You know, and that's it. He's like, you don't owe anybody else anything. Honest with your kids, that's it. And then it made me think, well, whose opinion do you value the most? Because he reached out to his dad. He reached out to me.
You. Yeah.
And he's like, yo, you know, I've known you forever and you've been through this. And, yo, I really appreciate you being there for me, man. I'm like, yeah, man, sure. Is that one good? You like that, Rolando? Sorry to get serious for you. Because I was on the bowl, right? But then I was thinking about it, you know, while I was taking a shower, while I was doing the scrub-a-dub. No, they're not still fucking. They're not together. And I asked them that, too. Rashawn goes,
that's a good question.
I know.
It's a fair question.
I asked them, too, just to make sure. Why is she so mad?
Are you guys still, like, it doesn't need to be, like, you're together, but are you occasionally, like, hey, we're here, like.
My buddy joked, said, if she gave me some anal, maybe. He goes, but no. He's like, no, man. He was joking. No, of course not. Yeah. He said, no, of course not, man. No, it's done. Done is done. So the question, if you're not following, is if you've moved on and you guys are done, you have to ask permission to the new, to the ex to introduce your kids to the new person. I don't think so.
No, you don't have to. It's not your job to protect that person's feelings anymore. You guys are done.
It's your personal life now. You know, like you're co-parenting, but you still have your personal life and you're their parent. You don't need to ask permission for things like that.
It depends on, you know, it's tricky, right? Because they're only separated. If they were divorced and living in the same house, they would have no rule over each other. But the separation is tricky because there is a divorce, I assume, on the horizon.
Yeah.
And Steve, as someone who's gone through a divorce, you know that every little thing is not magic. Everything can be used against you.
Why are they getting divorced?
In a court of law.
Yeah, legally and schmeagly and things like that.
So
right.
All of a sudden, you know, he did this. He had a phone call with his kids.
And we weren't and even officially divorced.
And then in court, it was he's taking them around or his whores. And I don't feel safe with my kids going around his whores.
Oh, I did say that to my friend, too.
That's when the whores start coming in.
I said to my pal, I said, listen, if this was some...
behind shake.
And by the way, I know he's head over heels over this...
New girl?
New person, right?
Is she...
Let's
describe him.
Then I'll spend it on a whore.
Is his wife... he make it seem like his wife...
His wife is Mrs. Grundy.
All right, his wife...
A good person, but Mrs. Grundy.
Okay, really? And who's this new girl?
Just someone his age who's everything that brings out the best in
him. I say his age because that could be one of the reasons why the wife... is unhappy because the wife
same age, not like some younger girl.
Well, no, you can see the wife being mad. The wife would be very mad just out of jealousy if all of a sudden the new girl is like
a bunch younger and hot and all full of energy, and she's like a weathered mom now.
The only way she would have a valid reason to be this upset is if my buddy was introducing his kids to like some random hoe. So it's the realization that it's not just some random hoe. He's serious about this.
Kyle wants to know who initiated the divorce.
Relationships just go their separate ways.
But they both were like,
but hey, I think he was the one that was probably the most unhappy. You know, she probably would have continued on.
Yeah.
You know, but it wasn't a good, wasn't a toxic relationship either. It was a dead relationship. There's a difference. Just dead.
Like, did they fight to reconcile and it just didn't work out? Or did, were they, is this like a long, prolonged fight?
I just think you get to a point where you're two different people.
I know.
You know, and like, I think that's what happened.
I look at you.
I'll tell you what happened.
You're
ready?
You're my closest.
I know. He's a lot like me. Ready?
But I'm saying you fought tooth and nail, whatever that means. Tooth and nail in your tire for.
Screw.
Tooth and screw in your tire for so long.
Yeah.
To reconcile and salvage what was left of your crumbling relationship.
Yeah, but a lot of that was too little too late. Vegas. Right?
But you tried sometimes, but there were situations also throughout your marriage where there was a fight and a blowout, and like the one in that picture, and it took some time, but eventually you came back together. So is this, it's done?
It's done. It's done. Stick a fork in it. You know why?
Because they were still living together, so it's hard to say done.
It's hard to say for sure.
Ready?
Usually when people are done,
they don't live together.
They go rent an apartment.
This is the deal. And it's complicated when you got kids. He's trying to be there for those kids.
What? Kids can't come home and stay over?
I don't know, bro. It's not my relationship. Clearly. People do different things. So, Rich, and we could wrap it up with this. It's interesting how people evolve. And how they evolve determines how the relationship sort of evolves. This guy is a lot like me, meaning I could still get a good laugh out of a fart joke, right?
Yeah.
Where his wife, when he met her, probably was on the same page, but like sort of turned into, I was saying, she matured. Yeah. And he's still like a fun-loving, young guy at heart.
It's the Mrs. Doubtfire.
Is that really what happens? You know, I don't remember the movie. I never really cared
Robin Williams and Sally Field when they were young. Like, she was like, you used to make me laugh. And it was so great. And then things just got.
She didn't want to laugh anymore.
Like, she didn't want to laugh anymore.
That's exactly.
Like, it wasn't enough. Like, he was a goof. He stayed a goofball and didn't mature. And she had to provide for the family.
He's still
and get
the
a
same
job.
Kid. He's still the same guy at heart. Right. And she's like I don't want to say like an old lady, but she acts like an old lady. You know how like certain men act like man boys, they're fun and they're fun loving puppies.
Has he considered moving out, but then coming back as a man dressed as a woman to be their nanny?
No.
Now you're talking.
Sounds like a good idea. So anyway, that's the story. Was he wrong?
Hello.
Is there a blueprint? Hello. Do you owe your ex the respect? Do you have to give her the heads up when you introduce the kids to someone new? That's the question. Think about it. Shove it up your ass. And I also posed a question to you. Whose opinion do you value the most and why? It's interesting to think about. Someone that's been there, someone that knows you, someone that you respect, a little mix of all of that. But whose opinion do you value most? I feel honored. I'm like, dude, I'm taking a shit, but I'm here for you, bro.
If the kids were little.
I'm taking a shit.
I was, dude. I was,
but I'm like, here for you.
I'm like, what's going on, man? What's up? What's up, man? Dr. Phil's here.
Oh, wait, hold on.
Dr. Phil. He's.
All right, what's going on, bro? What do you need?
So, the idea of him still living there is probably a financial thing, I'd imagine. Right?
I mean, he's not broke. I don't know. I can't answer those questions. It's just what they agreed on.
Yeah.
Like for now, you don't have to. They live in a big fucking house, so he could stay in another part of it.
What is he, in the East Wing?
Yeah. You know what I mean?
So he doesn't really need to be there.
Probably not. No, it's just what they had originally agreed on. And like I said, I remember having these conversations with whoever I was leaning on at that time, right? Like, yeah. My kid met the new dude. And I remember the person saying, well, clearly she must be serious about this guy. I didn't expect her to run that by me. We were done.
Right.
But the reality and shock of that was upsetting. Right? So I was like, dude, that's all this
it's
happening.
It's very official when that happens.
Yeah. Really, the only time it should be really your concern is when they decided to move in together. Because this is someone that's going to be around your child when she's there with your with the ex. So if someone's going to move in together, then I think that should be discussed. Anything outside of that?
Yeah, that's exactly what I said. I was like, if they're gonna go on a vacation with your kid,
right,
run it by the other parent.
Yeah,
that's part of the co-parenting process. Your personal life and how you're gonna handle that shit. Fuck that.
Like, are they coming over for dinner? Fine.
Yeah.
But is he staying the night?
Well, that's the story.
Are they moving
Think
in?
About it.
So tricky.
I feel like Rolando ruined my whole vibe of the story. Anyway,
no, he.
But anyway,
you misread his comment.
Did I though?
You did.
Did I though?
You did.
Did I though?
Because he was saying there's a multitude of comments today, and there usually are a little less.
Ah, Rolando, bring it in! Bring it in! I'm sorry, buddy. Not sure what happened there. Won't happen again. But Kyle also said something interesting.
That's why I don't date people with kids.
He said, I felt bad for Robin Williams. I don't remember the movie. I remember her titties get on
she
fire.
She was the worst.
I get it.
Sally Fields.
We see a lot of our friends in that scenario where our friends are still the fun-loving guys we knew in college or high school or we grew up with. And then they're like, their life hits the other partner. It's not always the woman. Could be the man. Life, but again, it's usually the woman. I'll go on record and say that. Because men are more fun-loving and goofy. Men are like dogs and puppies. Yes. Like, women are like cats and felines.
Yes.
Right? And they're a little like, You see your buddy who's this fun-loving guy. Hey, Frank the Tank, what's up? He's like, what's up, man? Good to see you, bro. And then he's with his fucking stuffy-ass Grundy of a wife. That's tough, man. It's tough. You feel bad.
In Mrs. Doubtfire, they both had some maturing to do.
Well, Robin Williams was sort of
not
living up to his potential.
Yeah, he was not only that, but he was like pretending like he was one of the kids. They needed a father, not a brother. And he was just goofing off and throwing parties, and then she was just left to clean up the mess.
Okay, all right. I don't know all the details.
Was she a see you next Tuesday?
Mrs. Doubtfire.
Okay,
she was a little bit of a see you next Tuesday.
Why do you say that? Like,
I know it's a great movie, but I don't need to watch that again. Mrs. Doubtfire looked like my doctor at the time, Dr. Vashana, this old Russian lady that used to take care of me as a kid, my old pediatrician.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
I think you need to watch Mrs. Doubtfire, to be honest.
Like, no, I know this person. No. I need to see the movie.
Watch Mrs. Doubtfire this weekend.
It's my pediatrician.
Watch Mrs. Doubtfire. And by the way, Robin Williams, he lost his job, but he did have a job. He did voiceovers. And then he lost his job because he was stood up to the, he didn't want to say something about smoking, remember?
Yeah.
But he had a job.
Yeah, life's tough.
But he was just very irresponsible.
You need someone to bring out that fun side in you, man.
Hello.
Or that at least appreciates your goofy humor and fun side.
I want you to watch Mrs. Doubtfire.
Yeah. I'm okay on that, man.
Oh, watch it.
I've seen it,
it's
bro.
It's a great American film. And
I've seen it.
Celebrate America this
week. I've seen it. I just don't remember all the details.
You ever see the Mrs. Doubtfire done in a
dark way?
In a horror movie trailer?
No.
You never seen that one?
I don't think so, no.
Yeah, anyway, look at it.
Thank you, Lisa.
That's funny.
Thank you, Raptor in New Mexico. Thank you, Rolando. I take it back. Thank you, Gabe. You see, we also learned another lesson. Out of context, sometimes you just don't, get the whole story. So, Rolando, I apologize. But that's what I did last night. I played Dr. Steve. And what does she say about the new person?
Hello?
Hello? I'm calling in regards to the ad I read in the paper. For the past 15 years, I have worked for the Smythe family of Elbourne, England.
I did house cleaning, cooking, and took care of their four glorious children.
Would you mind coming on an interview, say, Monday night at 7:30?
Oh, I'd love to, dear.
Well, I look forward to meeting you.
Ta-ta. Showtime.
Bottom
this is
line,
great.
I need to be with Joey. And I'll do anything to do that.
Listen, I would do anything. I just want to be with him. You know, I need that. So please, don't take kids away from me.
Hey, it's my doctor growing up. Dr. Vashana. Hold on, I have a question. Spot, you can stop it. See, my doctor looked exactly like that woman. I feel like there's a
different one out there. Give me the... Oh, now I feel like I have to watch Mrs. Doubtfire. The kids ended up finding out, right?
Yes.
Very quickly.
Don't you remember? Don't you remember Robin Williams was peeing and one of the kids walked in and freaked out?
That's right. So the kids ended up knowing and they were cool with it. Like it was their secret, right? Yeah, like dad's the babysitter.
The young one didn't know. And then they all found out, remember, at the restaurant when he was doing the Heimlich?
Yeah.
Well, that's the story. Relationships get tough.
I still don't know, by the way. Who orders jambalaya when you're allergic to pepper? I still don't understand that fact. Pierce Brosnan.
Is that in the movie?
It's in the movie.
Okay. Well,
watch the movie this weekend.
Dude. You watched Raiders of the Lost Ark.
I'm not interested in that movie.
You watched Top Gun recently.
You're going to compare Raiders of the Lost Ark?
What? Yes.
Yeah.
Indiana Jones?
Yes.
Yeah. Adventure. Mrs. Doubtfire is pretty classic.
Nah, I'm good with that. I know it's a great movie. I remember liking it. I just haven't seen it in a long time. Indiana Jones still holds up, though. That shit is good. Shit is really good. You know what Jordan said to me?
What?
I don't think that people really give Harrison Ford the credit that he deserves for being handsome. He's like really handsome. I'm like, no, man. Everybody knows he was a heartthrob. Yeah, I know. But she's like, yeah, but maybe she's right, though.
No.
I mean, I know we know he's handsome, do people bring him up in conversation as the most handsome?
I mean, he's old now.
He's just fucking cool. His cool trumps his handsome. I mean, even as an old guy, he's handsome.
I mean, he is, but how old is he now? Harrison
Ford. He's like 85.
Harrison Ford is.
He's like Kim Kardashian's 79 grandma.
79 years old.
Jeez Louise. And they're working on the new one. So anyway.
How old's Brad Pitt?
That's, there I am, Dr. Love.
Brad Pitt's 58. So there's that 20-year gap where Harrison Ford was the Brad Pitt of the time. Now it's Brad Pitt, and he's even old.
On a side note, I am so happy for my friend, even though he's going through this terrible, like, and it's going to get worse, and things get sticky and gross. But
especially with the new girl.
But when he speaks of the new person, I'm, like, so happy for him. I'm like, yeah, dude, because you deserve that. Because you're a great guy.
The new person, when the new person.
He's a great guy.
When the new person appreciates you and you feel like for years the old person did not.
And then you hear your buddy talk like so highly of somebody else. You're like, yeah, dude, you deserve that, bro. You deserve that. We all deserve to be happy. And I'm happy for him, even though he's going through a tough time. So thank you. Love advice. I'm always here for you. Even when I'm on the ball, give me a call. Yeah.
Oh.
Rich was trying to guess who it was.
I was like,
yeah, you know what, though? That friend going through the same thing. Okay. I see all my friends just, you know what certain women just love to do? I'm not trying to be sexist here.
Ruin your life?
There's a lot of piece of shit guys, right? I'm just saying from my experience, from my friends. They just break their balls. Like, nothing's ever good enough. Like, one of my buddies, he's given this woman, like, the best possible life. And she still puts him down. It's like, fucking
you
what?
You loser.
Yeah. Like, really? You just took her to, like, Africa. Like, what more does she want? It still makes him feel like he's a loser. Well, he's like, I don't deserve this.
If it didn't dawn on you during the Johnny Depp Amber Heard one, during that trial,
toxic.
When Amber Heard's telling Johnny Depp that he's a loser, I was like, she was mentally abusing him. Now you got Johnny Depp thinking that he's a nobody? Johnny Depp, so just... It doesn't end with just regular people.
Savage. It's exactly what he talked to me about. He's like, it's amazing to see it on that level because so many men go through that.
Yeah.
Yo, so much so that my buddy started like a He-Man Woman Haters Club for men who are mentally abused but can't really talk about it to their friends. You know, because what guy wants to admit, like, yeah, my wife, she's like, I think she's mentally abusing me, but I'm a man and I don't know how to admit that. I think she manipulates me and abuses me mentally. I don't know. He started like a counseling firm. A place where guys come to be like, yeah, man, I don't know what to do. Swear to God.
He started this?
Because there's so many men out there with women that just, they just put down their man. Their man is just trying to do everything they can to keep their families together.
Yeah, but I think we're all guilty of thinking we're doing everything right. I feel that way sometimes. You guys feel that way sometimes.
Yeah.
I think we all think, but no one wants to ever confront the issue like we did last week. No one ever wants to confront the issue. They just want to let it fester and then secretly blame the other person
for
being wrong.
You hear one side of the story too a lot of times, right?
So I think a lot of time people just let it get too far before actually confronting the issue head on. Case in point.
The end. Relationship talk.
Have open dialogues. Open dialogues are the key to life.
You've said that so much recently. Is that your new slogan in life?
That's my new slogan, and I think it's been helpful. Open dialogues are the key to life. Because no one wants to have real conversations. This is the person you've chosen to spend the rest of your life with. You need to talk about everything. What's bothering you? What you love? What you want? What you need? What you desire?
Desire.
What you desire? What I desire? What we desire? What are our goals?
What if you don't desire the same things anymore?
Either you try and get back to find common ground, or you decide to go out separate ways.
I want higher ground. Chili Pepper style.
Sometimes,
Stevie Wonder style.
Sometimes people are not meant to be together, and they've forced a square peg in a round hole. And that's okay.
Well,
sometimes they have kids.
I think
sometimes you're better apart for your children.
That's a tough one.
It is.
That's a tough one.
Life is not supposed to be easy. Life is not easy.
No, I feel like things got to be pretty bad for you to say that being away from your kids is better than toughing it out with this person for a while, at least.
I don't know, because if you can't be cordial, then you're only making
No, but I'm saying that's when it's bad. I'm saying it's got to be bad spot. Like, bad. Like, if you feel like, all right, we can make this work enough because we got kids and we don't want to, like, disrupt everything. You got to really start disliking that person and be like, you know what's a better idea? Be like, leaving the house I want to be in, and me
like leaving house.
Yeah, like, I mean, what guy wants to leave their home? What guy wants to get an apartment after his divorce? What guy wants to see his kids way less? It's got to be pretty bad in a lot of cases. It's got to be pretty bad for someone to be like,
I agree with Kyle. Say it.
Open dialogue and open buttonholes are key. Now, I agree with Kevin. He says, I should open up my own therapy practice called toilet bowl therapy. Where you get to talk about your shitty relationships?
No, it's dialogue.
Oh, toilet bowl therapy. Dialogue.
Dialogue.
Hello. Hello, Covino here. Yeah. Yeah, man. Sounds shitty. Tell me. Yeah, listen, man. Just be honest about it. Oh.
Like, honestly, that should be a stream of you just sitting on the bowl, doing advice. I'd watch that.
So what else did you do yesterday after you gave advice to your
I watched the Kardashians. I talked to Jordan about it, and she did make me see another perspective, right? And she's always quick to say, well, maybe your friends suck, which is always a possibility, right?
Wow, yeah. Is that her first go-to?
Hey,
maybe
listen,
your friends suck.
I'm going from one side of the story, right?
Thanks, Jordan.
No, but it's true. There's two sides to the story. And
I agree.
She said, hey, she gave me that perspective on, but they're still under the same roof. Maybe that's why she's mad about it.
Did she say roof?
No, she said roof. Okay. All right, so that was my Wednesday night. Here we are on a throwback Thursday. I'm throwing it back on lithium today. You know what's funny about that? It kind of ties into what we were just talking about. I can make some sophomore joke on lithium. And by the way, the previous host also did the same. He would say things like, yeah, that's tits. Like, that was his, like, catchphrase. So we're not talking that.
Yeah.
The previous guy was some highbrow, you know.
Yeah.
Maybe snarkier and I'm sillier, but still, like, dumb joke kind of guy. I make these jokes on lithium, and I'm talking to a slightly older audience. Slightly older meaning, like, my generation.
Yeah.
And maybe a little older. A tad or a chad. Maybe a brad older. And sometimes the feedback, most people love it. But there's that 10% of like, really? Did you just say that?
Yeah, I see.
It's like, it's so like, it's eye rolly to me. It's like, what happened? You want a hug? Come here.
Yeah, when did
come
you, here. When did you lose your sense of humor? Fun?
And I point that out today. If you listen to me on Lithium, I'm like, I see some of the feedback. I just want to say, what happened? Why are you so mad? Why are you so sad? Come here. I'm sorry you don't like stupid jokes anymore. But I'm trying to have a good time and have a good day. You know, I still laugh at stupid things. And if you can't, I feel bad. Bring it in. It's really weird. Like, I said something about, like, oh,
Man, that song brings me from 6 to midnight. I'm actually on from 6 to midnight. Just made some stupid reference.
Yeah.
Really? This is what I pay for? This immature idiot? Like, there's a 12-year-old boy on my channel right now. And it's like, all right, I get it. You know, I get it. And I know how to be appropriate in appropriate settings. But it's like, really, you lost your sense of humor that much? That much? That's sad. It really is. I hope that never hits me. I hope it doesn't. I hope that when I'm old, like Kim Kardashian's grandma, like Harrison Ford.
Who was sexiest man of the year once? Tell Jordan that.
Yeah, but maybe she's just so taken by him. Like she's like, I don't think he gets enough. I hope that a good fart joke still makes me laugh.
She loves old guys with earrings.
Because fat guy joke. Yeah, when a fart joke stops making me laugh, that means something's wrong.
I agree.
You know?
I never want to be mature. Like, you guys always get on me for being very immature. I never want to grow up.
I think you went in reverse. You're like Benjamin Button.
I don't want to be.
Harrison Ford through the years. Hold on. There's a. I'm trying to. Grow up. Does that sound good? 1998. Covino, let her know right here.
What about?
But Jordan, though, 1998, sexiest man. People magazine on the cover.
Sexy boy. Sexy.
Spot, show that picture.
He's just a sexy boy.
1998, sexiest man alive, Harrison Ford.
All right, well, since we're doing a free show today. Today's lesson?
Yes, Peter.
You won't grow up?
Peter Pan.
And listen to your teacher.
Thank you, Mary Martin.
Repeat after me. I won't grow up.
I won't grow up.
I don't want to go to school.
I don't want to go to school.
Just to learn to be a parrot.
Just to learn to be a parrot.
And recite a silly rule.
And recite a silly rule.
If this song sucks. Up
means it this song does suck.
Yeah, this song sucks.
What's this?
This song blows.
That song sucks.
This is the worst song ever.
Not me.
This song blows.
How do you know that song?
Of course I know this song.
Okay, just making sure. Rich doesn't
know. Absolutely know this
Rich
song.
Rich doesn't know it at all.
Dude, Rich was Peter Pan.
Shame.
All right, so Rich was Peter Pan in the school play. Definitely. If they had a school play for Peter Pan, Rich would have definitely gotten the game.
Green spandex?
You look good in tights. Sign me up. Just looks good in tights. Since we're doing the show today, Throwback Thursday, with a lot of different people, I figured I'd bring up the rando news, Rich, and like, really, like, let you riff on somebody's stories, because some of them are more like conversations and not just headlines.
And I apologize for being out of it today.
Dude's sick. Get off his nuts.
Yeah.
I want to catch something for being out his nuts.
I don't either.
I just feel like, I just still feel like ass. Like, I'm like, it's weird, because when you do what we do, you don't realize how.
You're tired as hell, bro.
Tired AF.
How, you know what it is? You realize that when you do podcasting or talk radio.
Nah, man, I'm a broadcaster who does a podcast.
You have to be sharp, and you have to be sort of like ready to strike.
No, people don't care. But they just expect you to dance, monkey, dance.
But when you're sick.
You got
to
strike first, strike hard, no mercy, sir. Yeah. Is that what you said?
No, but like when you're sick, this is like a bad job to have when you're sick, because you really do lose your edge. Like I don't have the edge. I lost the edge today.
Your gusto?
I'm a second behind on the punchline or the funny. Like I just. You don't feel that way when you're sick, when you're trying to do this, when you're not feeling well?
You don't feel good, man. I get it.
No, but it's a job that you can't, you could say like, oh yeah, well, whatever. Just cakewalk through it for a couple hours. It's really a difficult job to have when you're not feeling well, because the whole job is based on being sharp.
Like Iron Mike.
Bam. It's not my gut.
Like Mrs. Sharp, my geometry teacher. My sister Dawn had her. What's up, Dawn? You remember Mrs. Sharp?
Did she look like Mrs. Downfire? Oh, no, that was your. Yeah, that was your.
She did kind of
pediatrician.
All right, so,
come to butthead.
There's a story in the news. Again, these are more discussions.
Is this rando news?
Nah, they're like it's news. Yeah, you can give me the rando news, but it's kind of like I don't want to just read the headlines and be like and next.
Okay,
it's and a next, but it's still rando news. It's rando news. Okay. Covino and Rich at Covino and Rich. New T-shirts available. That's news.
News.
Don't snooze on the news, bro. Hog off champ is here. What's up?
Hey.
Did he really just say hog off champ? Like, really?
I think he's like the hog
off champ. Really?
What is this show?
It's like, fucking beat it.
What is it?
All right, so.
Rich, did you take a vid test? People want to know.
Yeah, I mean, don't.
Yeah, isn't that weak-ass home test that never works. Probably got the vid.
Oh, you got the vid.
Trying to stay away from this guy.
Yeah. You got the vid. That means we got the vid again.
An Uber driver, according to The Insider, and I got to credit my source, Jordan. An Uber driver.
Is she The Insider?
No, but she sent this to me.
Oh, okay.
Uber driver says she ditched her Toyota for a Tesla. Something that we're all thinking about. Gas prices. An Uber driver says she ditched her Toyota for a Tesla because her Camry, get this, her Toyota Camry cost $600 a week. $600 a week.
Yeah.
To fuel. So she's driving around so much and gas is so high. Gas alone.
Gas is too damn high.
Is $600 a week. To fuel compared to, get this, the big reveal, $450 for leasing and charging a Tesla Model 3. You got that?
Wow.
$450 a month compared to $600 a week.
And, wow, I think the quality of the vehicle, because you get to go up a level, right, on Uber?
Yeah.
Like, aren't Teslas like the next level up, like Uber?
Yeah.
Something.
I had an Uber driver in a sweet Tesla when I was in Vegas like a couple weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
And my first instinct was like, pretty sweet ride to be driving Uber. And he's like, let me tell you. He goes, I just charge this bad boy and I have no overhead on it. A couple miles here and then I'm just driving around the strip a lot. And
the charging adds up.
Dude, that's $2,600 a week times 4 weeks, $2,400 a month compared to four. I mean, it's just ridiculous at this point. And maybe that's, honestly, maybe that's the whole point with all this shit.
It's Barnes. What's her name?
Heidi Barnes. Uber driver Heidi Barnes told Bloomberg that she pays $450 a week to lease and charge her Tesla Model 3. Switched to the Tesla because it was costing her $600 a week to fuel her 2009, driving around a piece of shit, no offense, I'm saying it's an older car, 2009 Toyota Camry. The average price of gasoline, the average, which, by the way, we're like almost $2 above the average. The average gasoline price surged to $5 in June. Well, $5 a gallon.
And this is interesting. Barnes, who drives around LA, maybe this is a incentive, is one of 15,000 Uber drivers to have leased a Tesla since the company signed a deal with the car rental firm Hertz in October 21, 2021. And Uber also offers drivers a $1 per ride zero emissions incentive if they opt for an electric car.
You could rent them by the week, according to Rocket Poo. You know, a lot of people do this as a side hustle, but a lot of people also drive a lot for work. And you're realizing that you're burning through gas and you're burning through a lot of money now. It might be cheaper to fly sometimes in certain cases, you know?
Like a hunk of burning love.
It's like, it's ridiculous. So Tesla really making a statement with facts like this.
Well, what
like,
did they say? By 2040, most cars are going to be electric? Do you see that? That's
is that really the big agenda here, though, Rich?
It does affect like, I wonder if she's keeping track of her electric bill, because it does affect your electric bill. I've noticed since I plug in at home that my electric bill has gone up.
But, dude, you think it could be anywhere near the ballpark of $2,400 a month just on gas?
No. And we never, in my Volt, which is a plug-in hybrid, so it only has a small charge window, but it gets my wife to and from work, so we never have to buy gas in that car.
That's pretty awesome.
Fantastic.
It's incredible.
And like, then here's me filling up my Mini for $80 a week.
Well, think about it. Most of the people that we're talking to probably come on the road all the time, because we come from Sirius XM. A lot of people on the road subscribe to Sirius XM. My dad on the road all the time. It just makes logical sense at that point. Covino Logistics. Are you in the market? Do you see yourself in a Tesla?
I see myself in a...
Or do you have... You know what Jordan's conspiracy is? She reads a lot of negative things about them.
Well, it's
like,
the,
once you're like, what if they just shut down on you? What if someone sends out some sort of virus out to all the Teslas and so, you shut down?
I mean, that can happen.
You know what I mean? Like, you're driving a different kind of car like that. You never know.
They say that the batteries, not only are the batteries not as environmentally friendly as you think.
That's the other thing.
you're charging the car, so somewhere you're creating emissions, because until we go full solar, or unless you have a full solar setup at your house and you're charging only at your house, then you're not really, you're still using emissions and it's still creating some sort of carbon footprint. But if you can get a solar panel, a solar battery, which still is not good, and charge at your own property, then yeah, maybe you'll cut down more than the average person.
But at this point, $450, you don't need to be a Lanny Poffo genius to figure out
that's going to work out for you.
Like, yeah, you know what? $2,400 a month to drive this 2009 Camry, $450 to drive this dope-ass Tesla. You also want to be in a car you're cool with and feel comfortable in and proud of when you're in that car most of your workday. Mm-hmm. For $450,
if you're just simply a commuter, if you're simply a commuter, a Tesla I think is a great option. For long trips, sucks ass.
Oh, I bet. Yeah, because then you got to figure out like where to
charge, charging zones.
Spot has the Chevy Volt. He's the most knowledgeable in this arena. So
of the three of us, I don't have a Tesla. It's a different. But when I rented that Tesla, when I went back east, it was cool to drive around, but having to worry about just to go to upstate New York, we had to stop twice, and one charge, we had to sit for an hour once just to charge the car.
So you did that.
Yeah, we had to.
It's a pain in the ass.
But what about when the aliens come and they're like, we will take over all the electric cars.
Yeah, that'll happen.
And then we're fucked. They sizzle your fucking
Most cars run on a computer.
Yeah. What if they take over the computer system in the car?
I'm going to wait for a car that runs on
people who have fuel, the people who have, an old-fashioned engine. They're going to be like, fuck you, aliens. What's going to happen?
I'm going to wait for Mr. Fusion, like in Back to the Future, where garbage just turns into your fuel. That's the way to go.
On a Throwback Thursday, what was your first, like, I got to get that car when I grow up? On a Throwback Thursday, your first realization of this car is dope. I have two of them.
67 Mustang.
What you got?
It wasn't an old school muscle car. For me, it was the first time I saw a Nissan Maxima. Like, this is an awesome car. I loved it. But the first time I stepped into a Nissan Pathfinder, like an SUV, like, what is that? Pathfinder? I'm finding paths as soon as I turn 17.
I'm going to
that. Coolest. No, I never had one. I swore, like, this is the coolest car I've ever seen in my life. I can't wait. I like Nissans back then.
I loved my Civic Si. That was fun. That was a really fun car. I'd love a Jeep. I'd love a Jeep, with the pop-off top. I'd love one of those.
I mean, my favorite Matchbox car was one of those, like, that golden T-top. What is that? Magnum P.I.? Is that Magnum? Whose car is that? That, like, Firebird? No, it's a Trans Am. That gold Trans Am. Is that anyone?
Just
that classic?
Not Smokey and the Bandit.
See, who had that gold Trans Am on a Throwback Thursday?
But a T-top would be cool. That was always cool.
Gold Trans Am.
I'd love a Jeep.
Yeah, of course
I almost bought one. I almost bought one recently.
Well, anyway, Teslas. Yeah, the 1970 Act. Oh, it's the 79, 1980 Pontiac Trans Am. That Matchbox car I had was bomb. But in other news, the law finally caught up with R. Kelly.
30 years.
Fuck that guy. That's really all I have to say about that.
Well, hold on now. How old is R. Kelly? He's going to be an old guy out of jail.
He's like 75.
Is he going to be an old guy out of jail when we're older? Or is he going to, he'll die in jail?
I mean, I'm sure he'll get parole. 55. So he's going to be 85.
That's what I'm saying. Is R. Kelly's days of freedom done? 55 to 85. What do you get? You do 30 years.
Judge sentenced to more than 25 years. Is he eligible for parole at all?
Maybe halfway through? 70-year-old R. Kelly?
Yeah, the Juice Main. The Magnum P.I. had a red Ferrari for sure. I was just trying to think. Who had that gold? I think my Uncle Joey had that. No, he had an IROC Z. But yeah, R. Kelly, the law finally caught up with the guy. Clearly, he's been peeing on underage women for years. And
he got more time in jail than Maxwell did.
People are like, all right, enough of this guy. It's been a long time coming. Pun intended. Fuck this guy.
What did she get? 20 years?
R. Kelly, 30 years in the big house. But at what point, like, is his music that great where he's not cancelable?
30 years without parole. So.
Wow. So.
That's it.
No, like, people hit me up.
Later.
And they're like, dude, why don't you play Marilyn Manson? And I don't care. I have no control over this. I'm like, he was canceled, dude. What do you want from me? Right? Guy's canceled. Yeah. I don't know. Cancel. Like, R. Kelly, are we still playing this guy? He's no Michael Jackson. Promise you.
Yeah, but
I Believe I Could Fly is a great song, but it's not Billie Jean.
But the remix to Ignition is pretty good.
Fuck that guy, man. I don't like him.
So is that song just done?
I say, in today's world, why does he get the exception?
The remix to Ignition. It's a good song.
Why does he get the exception? You know what I mean?
Like, I guess he shouldn't.
Yeah, like, you got to be consistent on the rules then.
Is this the car you were thinking of?
It might be. But that's a weird picture.
It's from the Rockford Files.
Really?
Yeah.
I can't tell. I have to see from the top. Yeah. Yeah, that's it. With the big Firebird on top of it.
Yeah, that's it.
But R. Kelly in the big house.
Who's Scale?
He ain't flying anywhere.
Clink.
So, in other news, this is more of a Throwback Thursday. I'm still trying to figure out the story, and I actually investigated it and looked it up. But you know it's been 15 years since Radio Shack closed down?
Yeah.
15 years, though?
Yeah, I saw that, because didn't they tweet something?
It's weird, though, because I remember Nick Cannon bought it. Didn't he buy the rights or some shit like that? Wasn't that not that long ago where Nick Cannon was trying to bring Radio Shack back?
Crazy part about it is I remember that SiriusXM, when we were first involved, had a deal with Radio Shack.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I remember, like, it was one of the few places where Radio Shack, one of the few places Sirius, when it was just Sirius, was available.
On a Throwback Thursday, the thoughts of Radio Shack are intriguing to me. Like, if you needed a wire... Like, you didn't go to Best Buy just for that wire. You went to Radio Shack. You needed some sort of connection, some sort of battery.
Radio Shack still exists.
You needed someone to fix, like, your remote for your remote control car. You wanted to buy a remote control car.
Ham radios.
Radio Shack was the place. Like, there was always a reason to go there. I don't think I ever bought anything of significant value at Radio Shack, but I always bought, like, my stupid shit like that from Radio Shack. But maybe that's why they didn't last. But Radio Shack was such a part of our life, and it's gone just like that. Then last I heard from it was Nick Cannon was trying to bring it back.
Well, they filed for bankruptcy in 2015. Filed for bankruptcy. And then another brand bought them.
But Radio Shack now is tweeting, like, inappropriate things. That's why it's sort of a story.
Well, yeah. So yes. I didn't even get to that yet. So somehow there's a new social media person in charge, as far as I know and as far as I've read. It's like a young intern is what they're saying, I think, for Radio Shack. Now, I don't know if this is true or not, because I looked and I didn't see it. But as our buddy Will Morehouse posted on our pages, someone from Radio Shack said, if you find a squirter, marry her. I'm like, no way.
What?
And the story is, no, this is real. This is what Radio Shack tweeted out. And kids are probably thinking, what the fuck is Radio Shack? Kids, younger people don't even know what that is, probably.
What's a radio?
Radio Shack? What is that? I know Shaquille O'Neal. Who's Radio Shack? If you find a squirter, marry her. That was the supposed real tweet that they tweeted out. Because they're tweeting out all sorts of things. And I looked it up and I didn't see it, but I know that Radio Shack is definitely tweeting all these weird things.
Taking the second half of an edible after feeling nothing from the first half is always a bad idea. Is that true?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. And that's on the Radio Shack Twitter, right?
Yeah.
So, and again, verified Twitter. I don't know what the reasoning is. Maybe this is some sort of viral marketing campaign. Radio Shack's coming back in some weird way. I have no idea. Gabriel says Radio Shack was crazy expensive. Yeah, I do remember that. Did they sell video games too? I don't remember. Adapters to things, for sure. Boston Cell. If I needed an adapter to anything. Radio Shack. And there seemed to be, like, a sense of the people there were a little knowledgeable.
Well, Radio Shack apparently is trying to sell you cryptocurrency now.
Yeah.
Radio Shack's back in
with
the game.
An attitude.
With an attitude.
Covfefe. Yeah. They tweeted Covfefe. They tweeted at Miley Cyrus, I believe, like, you up. Like, it's just some.
That account is wild, and Rolando says.
Yeah.
How many batteries does it take to keep your account running? The same amount of batteries to keep your mom's vibrator powered.
Yeah, I mean.
I love a good
humor. Really? It's not a brand
is
anymore.
Is this the same guy on Lithium?
Really?
So Radio Shack is back at it, man. It's the Radio Shack attack of 2022.
Radio Shack.
They're tweeting that image.
What bugs you out more? The fact that
the five dudes around the girl on the couch?
No, but what do you miss?
Yeah.
The I know what you're going to say. But the Blockbuster experience, the hey, I need a wire. I want to go to Radio Shack. It's a throwback Thursday. For me, honestly, it was making my money and going to the CD store and looking at all the new releases, checking the bargain bin to see if there was something there, and really like making an investment and taking that risk of like, I hope this album's good. I miss that, man. Looking through, seeing all these other people, hearing other new music. Like, dude, that was a once to twice a week trip for me for years. CD store, man.
I know what I thought was a good one too. CD's nuts. The Best Buy. Best Buy's still around, but I'm saying the Best Buy linger. Like when you would be like, yeah, let me look at DVDs. Let me look at some new TVs. Like we're just walking around Best Buy. Still all right, but walking around Best Buy used to be something you would do for an hour or so.
This is another story. And hey, share your.
Do
you have one? Do you have one spot? Like, man, I really miss that. For me, it's the CD store. And Blockbuster is a close second.
Virgin? I used to love walking around Virgin. I mean, I know they still exist. I even still like walking around like a Barnes & Noble, even though I never buy books out at a store. But
it's the closest thing to the CD store. I tell my daughter that because she goes to Barnes & Noble all the time.
Yeah, CD store. I used to love Virgin Megastore.
Yeah.
There was the one downtown.
Dude, think about that.
The
all
one in Times Square.
Sam Goody, Coconuts, FYE. Virgin.
Goody got it.
CD, Compact Disc World, where I used to go. The Wiz.
Nobody beats
Circuit
a good Wiz.
City. PC Richards. The only PC Richards reference is when the Yankees strike somebody out swinging. If you ever listened to a Yankees game, watched any team play the Yankees, every time there's a strikeout swinging, in the background you hear.
What was in my head?
That's the PC Richards. That's what they do.
Recently, but by recently, I mean like probably about a year ago.
Newmark and Lewis.
Needed a printer because my printer went for my candle business when I used to make candles.
Gone.
I need to get back into that. So I need a printer. So I went to Best Buy.
It's the worst.
It's the worst, but the experience really brought me back. Like walking, I walked around.
Yeah, but you know what you do? You go there, you price it out, and then you search Amazon for that.
But I did that, but I didn't find much cheaper on Amazon. So I'm like, let me just buy it here.
I had a different experience than you. I went there to find something. They were unhelpful. They didn't have a lot in stock. And I'm like, this place, how is this place still around? I remember saying like, you know, it was funny you would say printer. I needed
ink.
I needed stuff I think it was a printer. I wanted to buy like a cheap printer.
I switched to the ink bottles. What is that? I forget what it's called. The ink.
Wells. All I know is that my last experience at Best Buy was a total like, yo, how is this place still around?
That's why everything's going to close down. Everything's going to close down.
I walked downstairs. I walked around the appliances. I checked out the TV section. Rich, I checked out the surround sound section. You should check that out. But it has that vibe of like, this is nothing. Everything here is too expensive. I'm not going to buy it. But I loved walking around and experiencing it.
All these things are going to close down and turn into Rob Dyrdek fantasy factories. That's my prediction. Fantasy factories. They're going to be all skate parks and stupid like jungle gyms for adults. But I was listening to another podcast, just doing research, right? And this podcast was interviewing a guest that we've had on before. Mr. Wonderful, Kevin O'Leary. That's a good dude. Love that guy. Love him. Remember what he said to us? I don't need to be here right now. That was the beauty of his life. He's doing whatever he wants. I don't need to be here. I'm here because I want to be. Well, thank you for your time, Mr. Wonderful. As every Best Buy and every Radio Shack and every store closes down, these malls are going to close down. And on this podcast, some dude from the Bachelor's podcast. I don't remember his name.
What's his name?
Tartic. I don't know.
Tartable.
I was listening for Mr. Wonderful. He said his prediction is that all of the malls that close down, because they're all going to close down because of the experience that Rich described at Best Buy. Out of stock. No one's helpful. They don't have your size. No one wants to deal with anybody anymore. Attitudes. Why leave your house? He's saying that.
I had a completely different experience. I had a really helpful guy.
Yeah, but sounds like, yeah, sounds like you had a rare experience. He said that mall spaces are going to turn into actual
Amazon warehouses.
No, like, give me an office building for a bigger company.
Oh,
each store would be that workspace because people, so they could be spread out.
Oh, like
people,
a WeWork?
He said that people no longer want to live in, like, what's going to happen to skyscrapers? People don't want to have 70 people in one elevator anymore. They hate it.
Yeah.
So if you want to have a good working environment, you're just like, you're taking an escalator up to the second floor. Everyone has their own little workspaces. He said all these mall spaces that we have are going to become workspaces for, like, hey, that's Prudential, you know, and they take the escalator up to the second floor.
Oh, wow.
No one wants to be like sardines in elevators with sick, strange people that they don't know anymore. Yeah. Best Buy will be a laser tag. It'll be a photon.
Yeah, it's you always talk about how you go back to your hometown and everything's different. Like, well, the mattress shop is now a hot chicken place, or there was a gas station there. Now it's a different gas station.
I love hot chicken.
Hot chicken's the rage, by the way.
Out here, I don't know what it is about Nashville and LA.
No, Rich is way more into the funky chicken.
Yeah, way more into the funky chicken, but the hot chicken places.
Hot chicken places are everywhere here.
Yeah,
LA is obsessed with hot chicken. And I'll be honest with
you, it's not my thing.
Oh, that's pretty good.
All right, the next story, moving on. This is rando news, but like a discussion version of the rando news.
I'm surprised he hasn't seen it. He's Mr. taking walks everywhere. You don't realize that there's hot chicken places popping up everywhere?
Did you go to the hot chicken place?
It's not your thing, though?
At the car wash? There's a hot chicken place. At night, the car wash.
That's really good.
Has a pop-up hot chicken place.
Yeah, I like those. I think that's cool, but I haven't really, haven't gone that route lately. Now, there's a story about Freddie Freeman. It's not sports. This is a story about you have to be in control of
your density.
Your density. You have to think about people you work with because a lot of times they're making decisions not necessarily best for you. It's best for their wallet.
And you and I have had this conversation.
Right, like, hey, wait, are you factoring in my what's best for me or best for, like, you financially? Because that's not best for me. And I feel like Freddie Freeman dropped the ball. Freddie Freeman, L.A. Dodgers star.
Did he get an error?
No, dude, this is a real serious story. This one hits me here.
That's wild.
Because here's the update.
They're saying it's bullshit. The agent is saying it's bullshit, but I don't believe him.
Okay, well, here's the story. Freddie Freeman was a lifelong Atlanta Brave. Okay, guys? He was embraced by Atlanta. He was their shining light, their superstar, fit in perfectly with the culture and everything else going on with the Atlanta Braves. Won a World Series with the Atlanta Braves.
Last year.
They loved him in Atlanta. He loved Atlanta. Okay? That's all you need to know. Contract was up, and he ends up an LA Dodger. Okay? He makes his first return to Atlanta. And they announce, and we welcome back Freddie Freeman. The guy comes out, and he could fucking barely keep it together. Watching it kills me. Watching it hurts my heart. Dude, here's a grown-ass man, seriously, who comes out of the dugout, and he's overwhelmed in front of all of his teammates, friends, family, and fans. He's, like, holding his heart because he's like, have you seen it?
No, it's...
Dude, tearing up. And it's a very human moment. It's like, wow, look at this guy, man. This is crazy. The Braves meant that much to him. He's overwhelmed by this welcoming and this applause. Understandable. Then there was another story where a reporter, he's at a press conference, asked him, man, how's it feel to be back in Atlanta? And he broke down and started crying.
Yeah.
So here he is. Look at him. Watch. He can't even keep his shit together.
Oh, they played that emotional...
Dude, look at this. That's their hero. He's on an opposing team, dude. This is like something from a movie. That's incredible. And props to the Atlanta fans right here.
Yeah.
Braves manager Brian Snitker is proud to present.
That makes me emotional.
With his World Series championship ring.
So, Spot, he was like the guy on the Braves.
He was the guy.
They won the World Series, and Freddie Freeman's. He was the guy that was on the Braves when the Braves stunk.
Yeah.
He was a lifelong Brave.
He's an emotional guy. And here's the other thing that happened, though, leading up to this moment I just described. He's at a press conference. How's it feel to be back in Atlanta? He was thinking about it. He looked out into the press conference, into the area, and he saw nothing but all the familiar faces that he knew. You know, oh, there's Hank, the fucking custodian guy in the locker room. Hey, there's the equipment manager, Harry. What's up, Harry? All the reporters. Dude, he said he saw everyone there before his eyes who was there his whole career, and he fucking broke down.
This guy's an emotional guy.
Yeah.
He's an emotional basket
case. But, dude, this was his life, right? But then something else happens. Yeah. That makes you say,
There's a twist, Spot.
There's a twist to
this. And the twist is this.
So then the story breaks out that out of nowhere, Freddie Freeman fires his longtime agent, right? Fuck's his name.
Casey Close.
I was like Casey Jones or some shit like that. Casey Close. Like, oh, well, why did that happen? And we talked about this on Fox Sports Radio, and this is before this came out. As of yesterday and this morning, the story, and as Rich alluded to, is it true or not true? I don't know. But get this. And I actually heard from this from our colleague, Doug Gottlieb. News reports allege that Freddie Freeman's agent, please pay close attention. Are they out for the greater good of me or the dollars here? Freddie Freeman's agent did not tell him that the Braves offered what expected to be a 5-year, $140 million deal, which turned out to be $28 million a year. Again, $28 million a year for 5 years.
It's one of your coworkers.
This contract, would have and should have kept Freddie in Atlanta. Instead, he took a $27 million deal for 6 years with the Dodgers. Again, Atlanta offered him $21 million more for 5 years. But the agent wanted the 6-year deal for $27 million. Now I get it. An agent's job is to get the most for their client. Yeah. But what was best for Freddie Freeman?
Freeman might have said, I'll take the one last year
to stay in Atlanta.
To stay in Atlanta because I love it here.
And now the guy faces criticism too from his teammates because when he finally answered the questions of, well, how does it feel to be in Atlanta? He said something along the lines of, you know, this, my heart is always going to be here. But I'm happy where I am now. And Clayton Kershaw and other Dodgers are like, well, what are we, second fiddle? And he's like, no, I'm just a human who can't forget all the years and the World Series that I just won in Atlanta and all the people that rooted for me here. I'm happy in L.A., but my heart will always be in Atlanta.
So apparently it's false.
I don't know. Really?
At least they're...
The agent's saying it.
The agent's saying it's false.
An agency is saying it's false.
That doesn't mean it's false.
But they're going after...
Freddie Freeman fired him.
They're going after your boy.
Doug Gottlieb?
That you filled in for this week twice.
If that's true, and you have to think about this too.
We need to make claims like this.
You know, who's really out for your greater good? You know, that's why I teach these lessons to my daughter, Melody. Now, Melody's a working woman, right? Melody. The only people that are really going to look out for you are you and like your dad, like your parents, your family. I said, you got to keep track of your hours. Make sure you write down all the hours you work. And when you got paid, keep track of that. Because no one's going to keep track of that for you. Like Freddie Freeman could have stayed in Atlanta, according to the story. And that would have been probably what he wanted to do.
And now, instead of being a lifelong Brave. Now he has to know that. The crazy part is a lot of times when these contracts happen, you never get to see like, oh, this would have been what I chose.
Yeah.
Like he would have chose to stay in Atlanta.
How could, you know, to play devil's advocate, how could he have not have known that though? He just totally trusted his agent. How could he have not have known that? You know?
I mean, you guys have put your trust in agents.
And that's what I'm saying, though.
And there was one agent we had that Covino's like, yo, this guy doesn't have our best interest.
There's one. I would argue that your last agent led you astray.
Forget agents. You know, people in your life. Wait, do they have my best interest in mind here? No. It's their best interest in mind. They'll spin it to make it seem like it's best for you or that they're doing their job and that's their job to do X, Y, and Z. It's like, yeah, but that's not what I want. Uh-huh. That's not my best interest. So, keep that in mind. And if this story's true, either way, you see something's stirring. Something's going on. Freddie Freeman is extremely emotional, but understandable. But at the same time, he also just fired his agent who got him that deal.
Pretty good story.
It is a cool story.
But they're denying it vehemently, as Spot said. They're not going to admit it.
That word. Yeah, they're saying... Let's see.
That's cause to fire
your agent. You only got one formal offer from the Braves.
Well, the Braves could squash this story if it's not true.
Doug Gottlieb, alleged that the agent hid an additional Braves offer and intentionally led him to sign with the Dodgers, despite the fact that he preferred to return to Atlanta.
Wow, huh?
But maybe it's not true, but maybe that's what Freddie Freeman is believing right now.
So did he fire his agent as a result of what Gottlieb said? Or did he fire his agent, then Gottlieb released why he fired
him? Yeah, he fired his agent first, because we talked about that just the other day, that he fired his agent. So something's going on there.
Where there's smoke, there's fire.
Gottlieb's getting a lot of crap for this.
He is, because they're saying it's false, so it's...
And we've never met him, by the way. Someone said, does a guy like that reach out to you when you fill in for him? We've never met him.
Yeah.
I've never met him or saw him or anything.
You guys didn't get your fruit basket?
No.
Oh.
It's weird, though, right?
It's weird. He sent one to my house. Must have heard about me.
Well, hey, it's just an interesting story. Now,
Oh, and then there's one more stupid sports story. I got to tell you, this is so dumb. So there's this guy, Clint Frazier, right? Who was like, he looks like Scott Farkas. He's this, you know... What they used to call him? They used to call him fucking, I don't know, like Red Thunder or some shit like that. Firehead or something. I don't know. He's a redhead baseball player who I liked a lot, actually. I thought he had a lot of potential with the Yankees. But he seemed to always get in his own way. Got hurt a lot, said stupid things, and just rubbed the press the wrong way. As karma would have it, he recently spoke out. He ended up on the Cubs. He recently spoke out. The day he spoke out and shit on the Yankees, like, yeah, fuck the Yankees. They sucked and their rules sucked. The Cubs released him that day.
Yeah.
The day they were about to play the Yankees. So he was about to face his old team. They sent him down. Anyway, he still remained in the organization as a Cub. But in an attempt to reinvent himself, and it makes sense, but it's kind of funny, Clint Frazier wants to be called a different name. So it's not about sports. Fuck sports. Imagine you've known this guy as Clint Frazier the whole time. We've seen it before, like Giancarlo Stanton and everything. But he's like, yeah, I don't go by Clint. I want to be called Jackson moving forward. I swear to God.
Jackson?
Yeah, and he expects everyone to just roll with that. And it's just funny, man, because imagine that happened in your real life. You're like, what? Wait, fucking you're Clint. I've known you as Clint for 5 years. Jackson, get out of here.
Jackson Frazier?
Not anymore, man.
Yeah, but
starting over.
Hold on. Giancarlo did that.
I think Jackson is, if I remember the article correctly, was his middle name. And he said, like, you know, that's what his family calls him and shit. And I get it. We see this in entertainment all the time. Like, hey, you've been saying my name the wrong way the whole time. I want you to fix it now because I'm famous. It's not Camilla Cabello. It's Cabello. But I get all that. But now he's like, yeah, I'm Jackson. In an attempt to sort of change and restart his career.
I still can't get over when Dan Cortez changed to Dan Cortese.
Just think that's funny. It's like, because I don't know how that flies in other professions. Like, imagine all of a sudden, I'm just like, yeah, I'm not like Steve Covino anymore.
Zoe Saldana.
I want to be, I want to be really connect with my ethnic side to get better jobs.
Added the tilde?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Over her the N, so I assume now she's Zoe Saldana.
Dude, I put the tilde over the N as like a joke sometimes. I know you do. But no, but autocorrect always puts it there, right? Yeah, if I type my name,
yeah,
Covino. Yeah, it says Covino, but sometimes I just leave it because I'm like, yeah, let them think that.
Yeah,
let them think that. If they're on the fence and they need diversity, maybe they'll hire me if they think, oh, his name's Covino.
Can I be Christian again?
Yeah, but it's like changing my name completely.
Call my name back.
Jackson Frazier.
I want to be Christian. I'm Christian.
Hey, we all need a rebranding and a restart sometimes,
I'm
right?
I'm Christian.
Who did this? Someone else did it. Not Giancarlo Stanton, but someone else did it, though.
He had a different reason, though. Mike Stanton was an established baseball player.
Yeah.
It's like when...
Right? So I kind of get that. So he's like, fuck it. I'm Giancarlo Stanton. Muy, unse, hizo parlo.
Remember when Mike and Boner graduated high school and they were going off to college? And Mike was like, maybe it's time you drop the Boner and you call yourself Rick.
Rick's the bone. Stavone.
That's right.
I want to be Christian again.
You're no longer Spot?
I'm no longer Spot.
But, Matt, all right, ready?
Actually, that's like can Spot. Can I be Rick Stavone?
Here's where you got to really put your head into the story. Because most times we hear things, they go in one ear and out the other. That's like Spot really coming to you as a man to man. Like, listen, man, I'm done with it. I'm at a new place in my life. I'm a man now. I'm Christian.
Don't call me Spot.
Yeah, you're like, what? Seriously? And you're going to have to respect that, I guess, right? You don't want to be a dick about it. But, hey, by the way, what if Doug Gottlieb like, gets so much trash for this story? If it's fake, he gets fired and we get the job.
Yeah, man. Not that I would hope that.
Anyway.
What's his time slot?
The one we're filling in for.
The one we've been filling in for?
Yeah.
Pretty good time slot.
Next week, we're filling in for Dan Patrick. I hope our buddy Jonah's okay with that. Anyway, Clint Frazier, who, again, he's sort of a scrub with all the potential in the world. A scrub, and I use that in a relative sense. He's better than me, right? He played for the Yankees, dude. But I'm saying in the bigs, he's now Jackson.
What about D. Gordon, who's D. Strange Gordon? Sometimes the guy adds a last name.
Well, think about it. Like, people who transition do this all the time. And speaking of, the swimmer spoke out for the first time. I actually didn't even listen to it.
What did they say?
I don't know. You want to find that Spot? Transgender swimmer that got all that slack and flack.
Leah,
whatever.
So what about the...
Said, I'm now Leah.
What about the Uptons? Wasn't there an Upton that changed his name? One of the Upton.
BJ Upton. And Change his name? Oh, he goes by Bonely Jonely Upton.
Bonely Jonely Upton, yeah.
Bonely, B only, and J only Upton. Bonely Jonely Upton. So, hey, like I said, transgender people.
Melvin Upton, doesn't he?
All these young kids nowadays, like, I'm non-binary. I want to be known as Carthen. Like, what? Carson? Carthen. What? Okay, fine. So, people do it all the time, and I guess you just have to roll with it.
What do you think is the biggest misconception people have about you, specifically?
The biggest misconception, I think, is the reason why I transitioned, where people will say, oh, she just transitioned, so she would have an advantage, so she could win. I transitioned to be happy, to be true to myself.
Can you pause that? I understand you have to be ultra competitive to take things to the level that Leah's at.
Yeah.
But there's no fucking way I would ever think that someone would take that route just to be
I would never be like, they did it just to get the medal.
Yeah, there's no way.
Come on.
There's right. No
way. Be realistic. And that's why too, recent news as well.
But people do say that.
But they banned, as a result of this, they banned, I think if you haven't started transitioning before puberty.
Yeah, they changed it, yeah.
They changed it where now you can't compete as a woman.
By the way, who transitions before puberty, man? Like, you shouldn't be doing that shit anyway.
Yeah,
give me a break. You're gonna fucking transition. Your hormones haven't even kicked in yet.
You don't even know what's going on.
Yeah, but that's fucking. You know what that is? That's abuse, bro.
But they give you blockers.
That's abuse.
It is, man.
To prevent.
It's ridiculous.
The change.
It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Ridiculous. I mean, I don't want to hear about it.
I completely agree with you, but
ridiculous.
You can't. Don't impose your beliefs on other people.
It's not beliefs.
It's not beliefs.
It means the kid hasn't even gotten a chance to grow up yet.
Yeah, and they're changing their sex? That seems like a weird influential parent.
I agree, but it's not your kid.
Well, I agree with Covino. I agree with Steven. So,
but by the way, I to defend Leah, the swimmer. What's her name again? I always forget her name.
Leah Thomas.
Leah Thomas. There's no freaking way that she did it just to be the best in the sport.
Oh, of course. That's that's ridiculous. So I agree with that. Now, can we hear the rest of what she said?
Oh. Yeah.
I thought you were done. It was a very difficult time. I was just stuck in this depression, and I struggled with suicidal thoughts. Being trans is not a choice. I didn't have any other choice because not transitioning was not leading me anywhere.
It's a long interview.
What are some of the changes that you experienced?
I started hormone replacement therapy in May of 2019. One of the biggest was loss of muscle mass. I had a lot of fat redistribution, changed sort of how my body. Okay.
Well, hey, first time she spoke out.
It's a whole lot. It's a whole lot.
I mean, it's a big headline today, though. Yeah, she spoke out for the first time. And, you know, look, she caught a lot of flack. She really did. So for that, just on the human element alone, like, you got to feel bad for that person. Like, the person is trying to be happy here. But should she be competing with other women is a different question. All right, so I have some shout-outs to give. What's up, Dwee Boobs? These boobs. What's up, these boobs? 76?
Yeah.
These man boobs. 76. Parker Stevens, what's up? He hits me up. He's like, what's up, Cove? That really stuck. You gave me that name and it stuck. Yeah.
Parker Stevens can't lose.
Parker Stevens can't lose. Tony Rometta, good guy. What's up, Tony? Eric Zander, what's going on? Colin Gillis, Raymond Shriver, Don Caldwell, what's up, Don? Goes by Don now. Mark Shapiro, what's up, Mark Shapiro?
Hey, Mark.
El Cucuy, orale. The whitest brown guy I know, El Cucuy. And Billy Boy Caputo, what's up? Did I say Billy Boy? Billy Boyd. Billy Boyd Caputo, or as I call him, Billy Boy Boyd Caputo. Billy Boyd Caputo, thank you very much for reaching out, man. I appreciate you. Thank you, everybody, for your time today, your subscription, just for hanging out with us all the time. We appreciate it. But that's the rando news of the day. Tomorrow's a new month. Anything else stand out in the news, though? Yeah, and tomorrow is a new month. So let's make it the best Julio yet.
Sign up tomorrow.
You're going to join us. I'll be healthy in July, and I'll bring it.
I don't know if it's possible. The best Julio spot... Because I said, let's make it the best Julio yet. Best Julio is definitely Julio from Easy Money on a Throwback Thursday. If you find me a good picture of Julio from Easy Money. Julio from Easy Money.
News.
Let's make it better than him.
Ketanji Brown Jackson was sworn in today.
I saw that.
That was all the alerts.
Supreme Court?
You mean Jackson Frazier from the Cubs?
No. I didn't.
No.
Am I looking up Julio from Easy Money?
Julio from Easy Money with... Rodney Dangerfield is my favorite Julio after Julio Franco.
Oh, I know this guy. This guy was
After Julio
this
Iglesias.
This guy was always like the sleazy.
He died recently.
Yeah, he was always
great though.
He was always the sleazy, '80s Latino guy.
If you want to talk about Julio,
go back Thursday. Let's make it the best Julio yet.
You brought
that guy.
You brought up Julio Franco, the baseball player Julio Franco, had the biggest ass of all baseball players. Oh.
Giancarlo Stanton hasn't beat nowadays, though.
I don't know. Look up.
Jordan's like, what is up with his ass? Like, seriously, like, how do you not notice it? I'm like, stop.
Julio Franco, who later in his career became Julio Franco. Julio Franco had a Mondo ass spot.
Did he?
Like, a Mondo ass. Like, he hit a home run at 48 years old. Oldest guy to ever hit a home run. So, good for Julio Franco and his major... Mondo ass.
If there's anything else you want to like...
There's no butt shots because it was the 80s and 90s.
That's true. Even when he's in the batter's box, you can just see...
They weren't into asses back then.
There was a clip I do want to... How could I find this?
There's like no ass shots.
What, of Julio Franco?
Yeah.
It's a shame. He had a cool batting stance spot.
See the best Julio yet? Well, Spot, I'm going to send you one thing just to end on, okay? Please. I'm going to send it to the Covino and Rich Instagram page. Can you send me the link? There's a lot of controversy on a side note again, I don't want to talk sports, but Tommy Fury is making this fight with Jake Paul difficult, it seems. And Jake Paul's calling him out. He's such a great villain. It's so fun. Julio Cesar Chavez is the greatest Julio. You're right.
I thought you were going to say that, but I thought you just intentionally left it off.
I went with Julio from Easy Money, bro, just to make it funny.
You bring up Jake Paul. You got to quickly mention that Logan signed a multi-year deal with the WWE. Did you see that?
No, I didn't see that.
Logan Paul.
I mean, it's a perfect wrestler. Perfect fit. Congratulations. That's awesome. You know, I sort of took this route when talking about Clint Frazier because I called him a scrub, right? Yeah. I mean in the baseball, major league baseball scheme of things. Because in reality, the dude's playing the game we all loved. I can't say I would want to trade places with the guy, but
yeah.
I'm not saying I wouldn't want to trade places with the guy either. Right? I mean, these guys were the best of the best. You know how good you have to be to make it to the big leagues, even if you're struggling? So when I said, yeah, Clint Frazier's a scrub, I did check myself before I wrecked myself. I'm like, well, in the grand scheme of the big leagues, because the guy's still fucking better than me, better than you.
Yeah.
Right? Like the guy's hitting major league home runs. Even if he has 25 major league home runs, 25 more than this guy, he'll always have that. He'll always have that moment. And I feel like we live in a world where we're so quick to shit on people all the time. Even when you don't mean any harm, like I said, he's a scrub. I didn't mean anything bad by it. Just trying to give you the picture and the idea of well, he's not a guy. He's not a household superstar name that you should know, but still kind of rude, right? Tyson Fury, and this isn't about boxing, so chill the fuck out. He's like, listen, people give my guy AJ Anthony Joshua a lot of shit. But do you realize that this guy's doing his thing? Anthony Joshua sucks, man. Fuck that guy. Put anyone who's made it out there who gets criticism. Fuck him. He sucks. Tyson Fury, who's such a great thinker and great personality outside of boxing, is like, hold on. He's my rival. And, you know, he's not even a friend of mine. But let's be realistic about this. This guy's, he's a champion in life. And I think we need to be reminded of that sometimes because we're so quick to shit on everybody. Spot, play the clip and it does make you think about, you know, how we have to approach things. And we're all going to slip up and fuck up once in a while. I get it. But let's just remember the reality here. A lot of these people that we are quick to shit on
are superior.
Are, yeah.
You know, in what they do.
Anthony Joshua did the unthinkable. He became the heavyweight champion of the world. International superstar. Here's Tyson's Fury take on it.
So Tyson Fury, and this is my defense of AJ. Everyone's saying AJ's a bum. He says he's that. He can't fight because lost a few. But AJ has made it in life. The man can go to the pub every single day and drink Peroni if he wants to. He can go on holiday every day. He can play with his kids every day of his life. So I don't want to hear any more of this bullshit about AJ says he's that he's useless, he can't fight. The man's made it. Be happy for him.
It's just such a positive way to like view things. What?
Spot? I like that filter he was using.
Yeah. But it really is. Like he doesn't owe Anthony Joshua jack shit. But he's like, yeah, we got it all wrong. And we do. And we're all guilty of it. And it's fine. It's like, this dude made it in life. He could do whatever he wants. And he's the bum. Come on. Be real sometimes.
It's like Homelander's flip out.
I didn't see it.
I agree, Dr. Ed. Homelander had a flip. I don't want to give anything away too much, but Homelander had I'm better than you type of flip out. And yeah, he's a superhero. He is stronger and better than you. When you criticize a baseball pitcher, you mean the guy that throws 100 miles an hour that made it?
You mean the guy that made it?
Yeah, the guy that made it?
You mean the guy that made it?
Oh, they suck.
And he could have a Peroni any day of his life.
They suck. You mean the guy on stage playing guitar in front of like 30,000 people in an arena? He sucks?
I just got to be... I know what you mean. Like, you know what I meant when I said that about Clint Frazier. Yeah, he's a .238 career hitter, which in today's world isn't really that bad. But he's a guy who's going up and down from the bigs to the minors.
Clint Frazier. I'm sorry.
Jackson Frazier.
Jackson
Frazier. But I think, you know, I liked what Tyson Fury had to say about that. And it's just good inspirational banter in a time where we're so quick to be like, yeah, this dude blows. Does it really blow? No. You just don't like him. He made it in life.
Like I said a few seconds ago, Logan Paul
made it in life.
Made it in life.
The guy made it in life.
Signs at the WWE. He's becoming a WWE superstar. The Maverick just signed the contract with the wrestling giant. 27 years old. he's officially signed on. And
by the way, though, this guy has
everyone's given, blown away by his performance.
He's given people reason to hate on him, just like his brother does, right? Yeah. So I kind of get that. Guy like Anthony Joshua is like a really like nice dude who people just say he sucks and whatever. But yeah, congrats to Logan Paul, man. That's a perfect fit.
And breaking news, Kevin Durant has requested a trade.
What?
From the Brooklyn Nets. So Kevin Durant wants out of Brooklyn.
Wow.
So that's breaking news because Kyrie said he's staying.
Imagine he goes back to... Nah, it's impossible. I said, imagine he goes back to the Warriors. Should have never left.
Well...
Because marriage like between, remember, like, it's all enough.
The marriage between Kevin Durant and Brooklyn didn't last long. Wow. The superstar reportedly wants off the team. Insiders just broke the news. The move is shocking for a lot of reasons. Number one, Durant just signed a 4-year, almost $200 million contract with the team back in 2021. So I guess he wants out of that.
Well, best of luck to him.
No word where he wants to be traded yet.
Another
There'll
guy,
be no shortage of suitors.
Another guy that made it in life, you know? So respect it. Doesn't mean we have to like these people, but you got to respect people that could walk into a pub and have a prony anytime they want.
Yeah.
Could play with their kids whenever they want. Made it in life, man.
Yeah.
So on that level, you got to respect it. All right. So thank you guys for hanging out with us. We appreciate it. Now, two things. Spot, new shirts are available, right?
Uh-huh.
We're not in it for the money grab. If you think that's what it's about, then don't get one. We just want you to feel like you're part of something. And if you'd like one, then get one. We appreciate it. They're there to either get or not get. Not for criticism and not for a money grab. Yeah.
Yeah.
So shop.covinoandrich.com.
I think they're pretty cool.
They're really cool. Shop.covinoandrich.com. That being said, thank you, Franz, too. He helped with the designs. We got a Dr. Green Thumb. We got a Everything I Stand For Is Awesome. This Rich's Dr. Green Thumb Landscaping.
Nice.
We got a quote that I said one time. Everything that I stand for is awesome.
It's a good one.
I still believe that and stand by that. We have the Rock On Cantina. No,
Marina.
Did I say Cantina? I meant Marina. The Rock On Marina. Read the quote on it, though.
Rock out with your hog out? Or no, on top. Home of the motorboating championship.
Yeah, the Rock On Marina. I love it. We have That's Cute.
That's cute. That's cute.
That is cute.
I like that it's understated. That shirt.
That's
like
cute.
That it's understated.
Rich's favorite.
I think I'll get that one too.
And my favorite.
Laughers.
Laughers.
Where Rich is performing every weekend. Laughers Comedy Club. Because Rich tries to bring the laughers. Today he brought the sniffles. And you forgot Dark Side of the Goon.
Dark Side of the Goon.
Covino and Rich's Dark Side of the Goon.
And it's square because Rich is a square.
Because Rich is a square. Because Rich loves Pink Floyd. Dark Side of the Goon.
Dark Side of the Goon.
I am anxious to feel better. You know when you feel sick and like you just want, you so badly like just want to feel better?
Oh. Hey,
so badly
sorry.
Just want to feel better.
Hey, you will. And you will.
Everyone's phone number.
And you will. You made it in life, buddy.
Right.
So that, and we thank you very much for your subscription for...
Yeah, for
Julio
sure.
For July. Remember, we're going to make it the best Julio. Better than Julio Cesar Chavez. Better than Julio from Easy Money. Better than Julio Franco. Better than Julio Iglesias.
Yes.
It's going to be the best Julio yet.
Perfect. And we'll see we'll see you guys when...
Oh, wait, you have one more thing to say.
Oh, yeah.
Make sure your credit cards work. You know what happens all the time?
I'm going to send out a note today.
Dude, it happens all the time. You guys doing shows this month? What happened? And like the numbskull, and it happens to everybody, but their card either didn't renew or it's not working. Like, make sure whatever card you use for your Patreon works. Because
I'm amazed how often that happens.
It happens all the time. So make sure it works. But we really thank you for your subscription. And, let's have a great month and have a great rest of your day. Have a great weekend. Enjoy your holiday, man. Holiday! Celebrate!
Ooh, yeah. Let's celebrate.
Fireworks, explosions, barbecues, cookouts, family time.
I assume we are off on Monday.
Yeah, that probably makes sense.
Yeah. Okay.
What would you say?
All right. Stay tuned on Twitter, man. At Covino and Rich.
4th of July.
Yeah, it's 4th of July.
By the way, happy Canada Day tomorrow.
Oh,
to our Canadian friends. Enjoy your day off.
Okay.
Way to piggyback onto our holiday, but that's okay.
Enjoy your holiday. And again, updates at Covino and Rich. We'll do some behind the velvet rope fun. I'm going to try to do one tonight just for the fun of it, just for the smell of it. I'll do my best either way sometime between now and 4th of July. But enjoy the holiday, man. Enjoy the fireworks.
I'll shoot firecrackers out of my butt on a behind the velvet rope.
Sweet. Can't wait for that one.
Thank you, guys. What's up?
If you need any advice, when do you plan on taking a shit today?
Dude, what time is it?
Yeah, why do you think I gotta go? Let's go.
Get up Covino in about an hour. He'll be on the bowl giving out advice.
Hog off champ. Thank you, guys.
And we'll bring it. I promise I'll feel better, and we'll have great shows next week.
You don't
have
to apologize for being sick. Fuck you guys. If you're mad at Rich. Fuck him. He's sick. Leave the fucking guy alone. Fuck off. But thank you. Love you guys. Bring it in.
Right. Hey.
Bring it in.
Here.
A little nut tickle. I give you nut tickle from behind.
Ooh. All right. Oh, by the way, Spot, are we working on the home run challenge behind the velvet rope?
Sure. I got to find a place to do it.
I think UCLA or USC or one of the colleges.
Suggestions, and it can't be like a little league field. I tried the Dodgers, but we want it to go through like MLB.
What about the Angels? Same thing?
Dude, I'll try the Angels, but it's like the Angels is kind of a hefty drive, but we can go to the Angels. I'll try them.
But, I mean, every field's going to be the same dimension. Like, college ballparks are the same dimensions as a pro place for the most part.
Let Jim Ramsey steer the show.
No, but I agree. I do want to do that. I do want to do that, though.
All right. Thank you, Jim. I love you guys.
Guys, have a great weekend. I have to get on a flight tonight now.
You're going away?
Hey, dude, I don't want to hear about how you're wearing yourself thin. All right? Have a good time in New Orleans.
Where the fuck are you going?
I
have to host an event.
This guy doesn't know how to say no. Pig will do anything.
Tonight? Right. Where?
Dude.
You're ill.
Yeah, exactly.
You just took off work for 2 days.
Gotta work. Gotta pay the bills.
Cal State, Northridge.
Cal State, do that. There you go.
You ever been to Northridge, Jim? No. I have.
All right, we'll see you guys.
We're going to be batting around an orange grove.
All right, I hate more than anything? When I say goodbye to a coworker. And then we walk in the same direction.
And that's what we just did.
We just did that. We do that all the time.
I'll see you guys later. Arrivederci, baby.
See you in the promised land.
Goodbye.